got Dr. Peter McCullough back, the best cardiologist in the planet, but the best paper boy who ever lived.
Oh, man, I tell you what, those days, Buffalo, New York, 2 feet of snow, digging into the paper box. Huh? You remember those days? Wow.
How much of those peaceful days do you miss?
You know, there's something about being completely free of any phone, any connection. Do you remember as a kid playing so hard and your mom and dad had no idea where you were? And they said, you better get home before it gets dark.
Before the lights come on.
Before the lights come on, right? Yeah. The street lights are coming on. I remember just, you know, beating it down the street on our banana bikes, getting home as fast as we could. You remember those days?
Oh, yeah.
So different now. You know, it's said that a child today, if they are out of touch with their parents for more than, I don't know, 3 hours, it's like an Amber Alert.
Yeah, no, it's the end of the world. It's like the world's coming to an end. Let's call the missing child department. When before, you would have to find us.
People are all worried about digital tracking. Have you heard about those digital passports, what have you? Do you know that it's not hard? It's already there. What are we worried about? People think they're anonymous? Forget it. There's no anonymity. Just check in at the airport. They're taking pictures of your faces. They say that basically we're photographed so many times per day. There is no anonymity. This idea that, oh, I'm going to keep a bunch of secrets. There are no secrets. It's a different world. You ever read Devil in the White City? Mm. Eric Larson? Eric Larson wrote about the World's Fair, Chicago, late 1890s. And do you know there was a couple thousand people who just went missing at the Chicago Fair? Now, the storyline is that there's kind of a diabolical doctor, and he's abducting people, and you know he's killing them and doing all kinds of awful things. But the bigger picture is that people would disappear. People in relationships they didn't like, they went to the World Fair, and they just went somewhere else, and no one could find them. Yeah. Right? If you lived in Philadelphia, you ended up in St. Louis, no one could absolutely, you know, reach you back then. We just didn't have that reach. But confidentiality, which is the protection of information around us, is essentially gone. And then anonymity, that is our ability to be nameless or unidentified, that's also gone. And we saw that with the pandemic. People said, well, where's your vaccine card? Well, we used to have what's called protected health information. It was protected. No one could know what your test results are. Now everybody has to fork it out in front of one another. What's your test result? So we saw the abrogation of what's called HIPAA, the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, and protection of health information. It seemed to just go by the wayside in the setting of an emergency.
When they say test result, no matter what it is, even a blood test, isn't that just, let's say 5,000 people get a blood test, here's the average, and here's what we're going to say is the normal. But my genetics are different than yours and his. So for an example, like my dad has high testosterone. He's 80, and his testosterone is 1,200 at 80 years old.
No supplementation?
No supplementation.
Good.
None at all. But it's just genetically. Like, he's always been like
that.
No
wonder you have such a full head of hair. I'll tell you what, you're going a long way. What do you think, Rob? Yeah. He's never going
to
go bald.
As long as this stays, I'm good. Yeah. Otherwise, I already have my plane ticket to, what's the place I wrote down that's really good? Tennessee Men's Hair Club. I will be the first one.
Well, I'll tell you what. You know, we shouldn't let this out, but the girls always ask me, you know, what's Tommy's status? And I said, you know, I got some emails recently from Dominique. So I kind of spilled the beans that, you know, Tommy may be, you know, kind of tied up. But they always ask, and they always ask, is the hair real? I said, yeah, he's probably surging testosterone north of 1,000. Good grief. You know, it's interesting. When you're a young man in adolescence, the testosterone level can be, 1,200, 1,400, 1,600. And you're a man as you approach 60. I mean, that dwindles down to about 400 or so. I mean, it is a slide. And with testosterone, there is a loss of muscle mass. There's a loss of energy and a sense of vitality. And many men and many doctors subscribe to testosterone supplementation. And it's had its controversies of whether or not it's a good thing to do. Should we fool with Mother Nature and what's called senescence, which is a normal aging process? Or should we try to intercede. The proponents say, listen, if you intercede, there's muscle strength and bone strength and agility. There's no doubt testosterone improves physical performance of, I mean, like activities, exercise. There's no doubt about it. Increases sexual drive, not performance, but sexual drive. And it clearly has mental impact. It changes the brain. But those who argue against it say, wait a minute, there could be a risk of provoking heart attacks or blood clots, or if there's too much supplementation, the testicles atrophy because the testicles, you know, feel like they don't have to produce any more testosterone because it's all exogenously administered. Having said that, it's a big industry. I look at each person individually. As an internist and cardiologist, I'm certainly not against it. And in my partner in practice, I'm now in McKinney, Texas. He's a real expert on that. So I defer to him, and he just knows exactly what to do. And it's interesting. So that's testosterone for men. You know what's a big deal is hormone for women.
But how can you judge that? Because the guidelines say if you're 300, you're low. But let's just say your whole family's 300. So I'm a guy, right?
Yeah.
Let's say my dad, my brother, my uncle, we're all 350 all our life. That's just how we are. We feel fine, energy, whatever. Mm-hmm. If you go to a clinic because that chart says, well, 300's low for your age, we're going to pump you with testosterone, and then we're not going to give you an anti-estrogen so that you keep having to come back and we can bill you for the testosterone. That's what kind of like they're doing with the kids. Like a friend of mine, he's 28 years old, went, got a blood test, 400 testosterone, whatever. They give him testosipinate, 3 shots a week, 300 milligrams.
Oh, good grief.
With that's no anti-estrogen.
Wow. Oh, that's you.
No Aramidex, no nothing. And that's what they're doing so that you can't get off of it. So now if you want to get off of it, well, you're going to feel like shit because you didn't
exactly.
Think, right?
Oh, good point.
So my thing is if my whole family's 1,200, I'm not high because I'm not walking around, you know, trying to whatever, everything I see. I'm not. I just feel normal. But that's my hereditary. So how can that blood test be accurate?
You know, that's the art and science of medicine. I always try to feel each patient out. Do they feel okay? Are they vital?
More.
You know, I don't personally take testosterone. And you know, I got up. I ran a few miles today. I did some push-ups. I sit-ups. I did some scholarship. You know, got ready for this interview.
And
everyone asked me, Dr. McCullough, how do you remember all these things for these interviews? I said, I work at it. I get up early. I commit things to memory. I'm precise in my statements. I think anybody in the public view should do that. But I don't take testosterone therapy. But I don't discount that some people truly, their body senses that they need more. Each person is different. It takes judgment. And I don't think we should hold any hard and fast rules. All of these ranges, by the way, are population ranges. And even within these ranges, there's differences. Even within the normal ranges of things. And let me give you an example. One of the hottest blood tests since the pandemic we measure is called D-dimer.
What the hell is that? No.
Oh, man. D-dimer is the measurement of the little fibrin split products. When a blood clot forms, there's little strands of fibrin. It's a protein that starts to stop the bleeding. Well, the body, as it forms these strands, the body wants to clear them out. So it has fibrinolytic enzymes that actually snip it. And these little fragments you can measure. It's called the D-dimer test. Well, it was noticed in COVID that the D-dimer test went through the roof. And we said, wait a minute, there must be clotting. And then thrombolysis, clotting and thrombolysis. So D-dimer became this hallmark of COVID and blood clotting. Mm. And then sure enough, with the vaccines. So we're measuring a lot of D-dimers. But what we're noticing, because we're measuring so many, that even through a range of normal, those at the high end of normal, ooh, looks like a little bit more vaccine effect compared to those at the low end of normal. And we're trying to come up with strategies to deal with it.
Wow. I just think those blood tests, unless it's a doctor that really cares, it's just a money-making machine as well.
Well, come on.
You go to like lab tests now.
Well,
you come out, this who probably in cahoots with this compound.
Yeah, you're low. Yeah.
Well, Tommy, that's because you're hanging out with all these guys with all these tattoos, pumping the iron. I know these girls too. Come on. About 70% of all medical diagnoses and management come through the laboratory. Most laboratory tests, in terms of their true cost, are pennies to a few dollars. They're not expensive. And they're so precise. The beautiful thing about labs is that they don't lie. You know, your sodium is what it is. Your body maintains your sodium between 138 and 142 milliequivalents per liter for sure. And mine's no different. You're probably 140, I'm 140, Rob's probably 139. And we just, you know, the precision on labs is incredible. The data behind the labs is incredible. And they are very useful. If we did labs on you and your blood hemoglobin is down, I'd say, Tommy, you're burning the midnight oil too much. Maybe you got a stomach ulcer and you're losing blood through your GI tracts slowly and you don't feel it. We're able to diagnose certain cancers by a blood test, including the PSA, the prostate-specific antigen. That's a prostate cancer blood test. Super useful. I had a patient in my office yesterday with prostate cancer, and we are going through all the permutations on that. So the clinical use of the lab is important. I think every adult ought to have annual labs. The real question is, should people really go nuts with these things, is what you're seeing.
And well, you know, like, you're a good doctor. So even if somebody's high or low on something, you're going to go furthermore. How do you feel? What are you doing? Okay, let's go to the next test before we start pumping you with drugs.
Oh, sure. And we don't order tests if there's not a reason. Now, the FDA says there's four reasons to get a test. Four, not just one.
That's true, yes.
Four reasons to get a test is, one, to screen and detect disease, like doing a screening PSA for prostate cancer. The second one is to make a diagnosis, like, I ordered your blood hemoglobin. It's low. You have anemia. Your diagnosis is anemia. Or I measured your iron levels, your iron saturation and ferritin, and you're low. You're iron deficient. So that would be establish a diagnosis. The third one's important, and that's prognosis, to establish a prognosis. What's the forecast for you? So a good example there is in heart failure, we measure a test called the blood BNP. It forecasts how people are going to do. In kidney disease, we actually measure a test called the creatinine, and we can calculate it was called the estimated GFR. It forecasts whether or not someone's going to really get in trouble and go on dialysis or not. And then the fourth reason to order a test is actually to manage the disease. So a good example would be the hemoglobin A1C in diabetes. So we're managing, we need insulin. You don't need insulin. You need this drug or that drug. It's based on the hemoglobin A1C. So there's four reasons to order a test. Now, I've heard a lot of doctors on round say, the only reason to order a test is if it changes your management. Not true. That's only you know, one out of four. So we order tests for explanation. I just worked on a Substack this morning, and I've been following the whole COVID vaccine debacle, as you know, and a lot of innovations coming out of Japan.
Why Japan? Why is it? I keep hearing Japan.
I love the Japanese. The best word that describes the Japanese is they're assiduous, meaning they just have a precision, and they're persistent and disciplined, and they just stay after something. You know, they're very serious people.
Let's face it. After a night with drinks, I don't bounce back the next day like I used to. I have to make a choice, either a great night or a great next day. That is until I found Zbiotics. We all have busy lives these days and can't afford to waste the day stuck on the couch because of a few drinks the night before. Zbiotics is the answer we've all been looking for. Zbiotics pre-alcohol probiotic is the first genetically engineered probiotic. It was invented by PhD scientists to tackle rough mornings after drinking. Here's how it works. When you drink, alcohol gets converted into a toxic byproduct in the gut. It's this byproduct, not dehydration, that's to blame for your rough next day. Zbiotics produces an enzyme to break this byproduct down. It's designed to work like your liver, but in your gut, where you need it most. Just remember to drink Zbiotics before drinking alcohol. Drink responsibly and get a good night's sleep to feel your best tomorrow. Order Zbiotics now for your summertime barbecue, weddings, vacations, you name it. Go to zbiotics.com/mscsmedia or scan the QR code on the screen right now to get 15% off your first order when you use mscsmedia checkout. You can also sign up for a subscription using my code so you can stay prepared no matter the time or occasion. Zbiotics is backed with a 100% money-back guarantee, so if you're ever unsatisfied for any reason, they'll refund your money, no questions asked. Remember, head to zbiotics.com/mscsmedia, use the code mscsmedia at checkout for 15% off. Thank you, Zbiotics, for sponsoring this episode. Growing up, cereal was one of the best parts of being a kid, but as I got older, started working out, I had to watch out for sugar and empty carbs. Magic Spoon has the amazing flavors you'll love, but high protein and less sugar. The variety pack, 4 flavors, cocoa, fruity, frosted, and peanut butter. This pack has 0 grams of sugar, 13 to 14 grams of protein, and 4 to 5 net grams of carbs. Only 140 calories per serving. It's high protein, 0 grams of sugar, keto-friendly, gluten-free, grain-free, and soy-free. The fruity one, I'm done for. I can eat the whole box, no problem. Go to magicspoon.com/MSCS to grab a variety pack and try it today. And be sure to use promo code MSCS at checkout to save $5 off your order. And Magic Spoon is so confident in their product, it's backed with a 100% guarantee. So if you don't like it for any reason, they'll refund your money, no questions asked. That says something. Remember, get your next delicious bowl of high-protein cereal at magicspoon.com/MSCS and use the code MSCS to save $5 off. Thank you, Magic Spoon, for sponsoring this episode.
A friend went there and almost lost his mind. He went on like the subway to move around and nobody talks. Everybody respects everybody.
Yeah.
Nobody litters, throws their gum. He couldn't believe it. He was like, this is the cleanest place I've ever been. And everybody respects everybody on the subway. Nobody talks.
Even though they're really packed in, right?
Yeah, they're packed in, but everybody's just very respectful. Nobody litters. Yeah. They probably cut your hand off if you litter over there. But
You know, I chaired a whole clinical trial program for the Japanese, several different companies. And I'll never forget, we got to these junctures where we had to make decisions on whether or not the investment continues in this clinical trial. And these guys would fly over from Japan and they'd be so tight-lipped, they wouldn't say a word. And then, you know, they'd just be listening intensively. You could just feel the tension in the room because, yeah, I was thinking, gosh, you know, if we decide to kill the program, these guys lose their job.
Right.
These guys lose their job. They may take their lives. I mean, they're that serious. At the break,
like how high are we up right now?
These guys would you know, at the break go outside and just smoke like fiends.
Chain
you know?
Smoke. Yeah, they're working probably 37 hours in a day that there's only 24.
Yeah. Right. So the point is, the paper that's going to, I'm going to have it come out on my Substack because I meter them out so I don't overwhelm the audience on Substack. But so it's going to come out, but I just did it today, is they've been studying the EKGs of people who've had these cardiac arrests after the vaccine. Very useful, and they've come up with something. So there's a little pattern to look at. And I have not been in my office looking at this pattern as I should, so they really taught me something. And the conclusion was that we can actually now apply artificial intelligence to EKGs, which is interesting because an EKG has a standard set of curves. I think everyone recognized the P, Q, R, S, and T waves of an EKG. Well, there's a lot of information there. Every single dot, every single inflection, is it going up and down, the angles, you know, the intervals. And if one actually integrates that all in a big computer model and did it in millions and millions of people, you could find patterns, and the patterns could really predict who's going to get in trouble because, as you know, almost every day another athlete drops.
Mm-hmm. I bet you. Yeah. I bet you the agenda absolutely despises Japan.
Well, you know, it's just they have the same issues in Japan. They're suing the companies right now. There's legal efforts. There's kind of good guys and bad guys in Japan as well. The challenge that the Japanese have in general, and I've been going to cardiology meetings and medicine meetings now for decades, is just the language thing. And so they tend not to get oral presentations. They present their posters. They have to present in their, you know, the English language literature, and the paper gets out there. But they're not out there to, you know, they don't get to get on Tommy's podcast and explain their graphical abstract. And I think that's the challenge. Now, the Chinese are interesting. I have been to China 5 times. And when the first time I went to China in the 1990s, you know, everything was tight. I flew into that Beijing airport. It felt like it was like a Soviet era thing. It was all gray and kind of dour. Restrooms were terrible. And when I got to the immigration line, this guy with little beady eyes, and he opened my passport. He looks at the passport. He looks at me. Then he looks at my passport. Looks at me. Then he looks at my passport. Looks at me. Then he goes, and he stamps it. And then he did. Then I know. I said, these guys are just, they're following a protocol. You better look at somebody in the eyes 3 times, right? Yeah. And then we got into China. This is in the 90s.
Which I think is so great. I think it should be done that way.
So I get in my hotel, and I'm in Beijing. And I said, okay, I'll get up in the morning, and I'm going to go run. And this is in the 1990s. Well, there's a couple of, like, skinny little guys at the hotel doors with, like, machine guns, and they're wearing military things. And I said, I'm going to go run outside. Is that okay? And they just kind of, you know, didn't understand me. So I went outside, and then all of a sudden I just got, almost got mowed over by about a million bicycles in the bicycle lane. I mean, it was just, it was a frenzy. These guys, it was just, and there was guys riding, girls riding side saddle in their skirts. And there was a couple industrious guys that set up little bicycle repair stations along the way because people, everyone's getting, everyone's getting flats. Yeah. And it was amazing. So, you know, the Tour de France. That was in the 1990s. The last time I went was right before the Olympics, and I was right back in Beijing, and I was right outside that the cube. Remember the cube?
Yeah.
The thing they made there? No bicycles. None. You could barely, you found one old man who had some sack on his shoulder riding a bike. They're gone. Bicycle's gone. Everyone's driving cars, or they're riding in subways or buses. They are not riding bicycles anymore. The old Beijing airport mowed down, I think by eminent domain, they took a zillion acres and they built what's called Terminal 3. Terminal 3 in Beijing is the largest structure under glass in the world.
Wow.
No.
You know, hundreds and hundreds of gates. It's like, it's a opus magnus of glass engineering. And I remember saying to my wife, I said, you know what? The Chinese aren't going to militarily invade anybody. Because all it takes is one little bomb to drop over Terminal 3 and all that glass shatters and it's back to square one. But the point is about the Chinese, since the 1990s to now, when I would go to a lecture hall, everything was translated. I had to go really slow. And then we said, for heart disease, we give an aspirin and everyone's taking notes. And it was just so basic. Last time I went to China, full English, no bicycles. And they're like, you sit in the audience and we're going to teach you about what we've learned.
Wow.
I'm like, okay. So, I mean, I got to tell you, 20, 30 years, China's completely changed. Japan has always had the discipline. They emerged out of World War II. You know, they reconfigured their society. They've always had tremendous discipline. Remember, they were great warriors as a warrior nation. And, and they really excelled. I mean, the auto industry, look what they've done in the auto industry, consumer electronics.
Yeah.
And, it went made in Hong Kong. Then it went made in Japan. Now it's made in China. So the manufacturing just hopped around, and the Japanese are up there. But they are clearly leading the way on vaccine-induced myocarditis. Very disciplined. We just have to survey what they're doing, try to interact with them. Very hard to do a Zoom with the Japanese because we can't largely understand them.
Because you can't.
The language is too hard. Plus, I know you love Zoom so much.
Are
you a big Zoom guy?
Every time.
What a nightmare.
We absolutely love
person
playing.
Freezes and we talking over each other.
You know.
Well, I mean, what happens in Zoom when it starts to take on this wang, 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 wang?
Yeah.
I mean, is that, are people going into the Matrix?
Yeah.
It almost seems like, it seemed like, I feel like a Keanu Reeves. I was just going into the Matrix, you know, like a Neo. But, you know, Zoom has, Zoom and of course all the other platforms have been part of this great reset, whether we like it or not, a great reset has occurred. Do you know people nowadays actually completely get new jobs, start new jobs, and develop all their work relationships by Zoom? Sometimes they never meet their boss face-to-face.
Ever. I just saw a story about that.
I know, but why? Now, we have 3,000 satellites in space, 30,000. How can you not make a better Zoom? How can you not make a better virtual experience?
Oh, don't get me going. I mean,
you have a rocket that goes up to outer space, all the way up.
Got a rover on Mars.
With a car, if it feels like it. Comes back down and lands, and we can reuse it. But I can't talk to you virtually without a delay or some type of headache. Do you have any?
Don't get
me going. You're the one with 20 years of schooling.
I mean, yeah, don't get me going. Have you ever watched that Saturday Night Live? It's been decades ago, about AV Guy.
No.
Do you remember the guy? It's in a class. They're in a class, and the teacher's struggling with something, you know, an overhead or a PowerPoint, whatever it is. And they said, everyone goes, we need the AV guy. And, of course, it's the nerdiest guy in the class, and he goes lunging forward, and he saves the teacher because he's the only guy who can log in and do something. You know what I mean?
Where the hell is he?
But the point is, Why can't we get something that works? The analogy would be, do you remember when we were kids and we got our first cars? Like, you had to know how a carburetor worked. Yeah. You actually had to be able to take off the air filter, get in the carburetor, spray some stuff, kind of jack it a few times, kind of crank it. You know, you had to do stuff like that.
I used to spend $50 for a Can-Am air filter just so it would be louder. It was the cool thing. Oh, changes. Take out the catalytic converter. Yeah. So
and
it'd
then,
be louder.
And then kids got really creative where they would have this nitrous. You remember the nitrous?
Yeah, I had a speed sticker. I had nitrous on the back.
Well, here's the girls point. Here's the point. When we grew up, you actually had to know about cars to actually safely drive a car because stuff could break down. You could get stuck. And now we don't need to know about cars. You get in a car. You don't even know what's underneath the hood. You just hit go. Computers are still in this age where you pretty much have to know about computers. It's like having to know about carburetors 15 years ago or 20 years ago. You have to know about control, alt, delete. It's freezing. Oh, you got to do this. You got to restart.
Right. It's not autopilot.
It's not. And so all these kids going into computer science, I talked to them. I said, what are you going into? Computer science. I said, listen, kid, you want a career? Why don't you make something that works?
Just make me a good Zoom kid. Yeah, how much do you want?
Yeah, it's just make me something. I want something that works. It's just endless fixes. The computer glitches. It goes on and on and on. People are frustrated. You see so many people struggling with their phones and can't, there was some glitch here and there. And, it just seems like we're in this difficult time right now. Let me tell you what, in medicine, in the clinic, computers are hell.
Really?
Hell. People come in, well, doctor, I went to the Mayo Clinic. I went over here. I went to 16 hospitals. And all my records are in the computer. And, they show up in flip-flops and shorts. I said, lady, I am looking at a blank screen. Maybe I could get to a record that's in a PDF that could be tens of thousands of pages. Uh-huh. How am I ever going to get to the MRI? How am I going to get to the lab test? Medical records are an absolute mess. In the olden days, we actually had a paper chart, and it said laboratories, tab. Oh, there's the labs. There's your lab results. Another tab, x-rays. Oh, there's your x-ray results. No more.
You mean filed, organized?
You could actually, right now, right. It is a total mess. Okay. The screens quickly get to about 2-point font. I mean, you're just,
Oh, wow.
And so I tell the patients, listen, you better get a binder. And if you had a major operation, get a copy of the operative report and put it under operation.
So much easier.
You just come in, because you and I can look at each other in the eye and we can go over it, because I can't be over on this screen trying to be weeding through a 10,000-page PDF. Here's my vision, though. I'd like to see this. I'm 60 years old. I'd like to see it in my career to have the medical office be just like the Avengers, Iron Man, Mission Impossible. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You go in a room. Oh, Tommy, it's great to see you. Labs up. EKG up. MRI up. And everything's showing up in the air.
Just like the Matrix.
Yeah. Tommy, your kidney function is there. Oh, look at your heart. Right there is a concern. Look at it. And just look up. And I'd say, okay. And then what I would do is I would examine you. And then I'd say, I think, Tommy, you have a heart condition manifested by these 3 points. Here's the therapeutic plan. 1, 2, 3, 4. We're done. All of my thoughts, all of our interaction is captured, perfectly documented, and I walk out of the room happy, and you walk out of the room happy, and I move on. Instead, my life is
hell.
User ID, password, Citrix WinFrame, user ID, password.
I always loved the old passwords for everything, and I can't stand it at this point. Like, fuck, I forgot my password. I know there's LastPass and all that, but I'm like, can we just get to a point where I have my thumb, my fucking eyes, like you can do open your iPhone. It's just frustrating to me.
All of these systems, passwords are impediments to progress. They really are. How many times have you just been boxed out of something because you can't snag the password?
I forgot the password to that computer. Nightmare. It got locked up. And that's like the M1 tour or whatever, Matt. It just got locked. We updated something. And we hadn't logged in for so long, I cannot remember the password.
So we had guests here waiting an hour. I'm trying to guess the password. I had to hack into my own computer and reset the password from here. So it was a mess over these passwords. But with Iron Man is what I'm thinking when he's going like this.
Yeah.
I really thought by now we would be almost there.
Yeah, come on. I mean,
you know they have it.
I mean, make
you
this
know
struggle over with. Electronic medical records have absolutely crippled medicine right now. We're actually guessing a lot more in the office, the operating room, and the hospital because we don't have all the information presented to us in a way. And ever since we left the paper record, I've never felt as confident as I was as a doctor back then because I actually had the information.
Everything there.
And it's just so
but
hard.
But you do think that's available. You do think the Iron Man.
I mean, come on.
There's no way they can't make it.
If Marvel Comics they have do it. I mean, come on. Well, I mean,
you bring up an interesting point because my mom, she had two kidney transplants, polycystic kidneys.
Oh, wow.
So she's, you know, on all these anti-rejection medication with this, with that, with this. So she's got like a couple different doctors she has to go to. And it's like, I don't understand how, but through like their systems, like, oh, we didn't see that on here. And then, well, this medication interacts with this one. That's why your blood pressure is high. And this interacts with that. It's like, how the fuck with all this thing that you can't have all this stuff together where the next doctor you go to sees, okay, this is what the doctor prescribed this. It's like a nightmare.
Well, you know, years ago, I played an advisory role on President Clinton's, Hillary Clinton's, you know, healthcare panel for Bill Clinton was the president and she was trying to head up this healthcare panel. And, you know, I was asked, do you want to be on it? And so I was on health information side, me and a cardiac surgeon. And I'll never forget, this is in the 90s. And we were going to Washington a lot. And we were trying to put forward legislation. And I was saying, listen, we need wide open communication. So if you get tested over at this hospital, the other hospital needs to see it. It all needs to be integrated because their care is fractured. We're never going to be able to see what's going on. And so me and the surgeon, we were like, yes, we need to open records, open this and that. And then we were stormed by the privacy people.
Oh.
And the privacy people came in, and what was going on was the HIV epidemic. No. People said, listen, if we get HIV results, get out there, and there's no privacy, people are going to lose their jobs, and we have to have health. And so we actually debated. We never wrote legislation that was ever got up for a vote. And we basically were disbanded after, I don't know, a year or more at work. And then Donna Shalala came in. She was heading Health and Human Services. And over a weekend, she wrote the legislation, HIPAA, Health Insurance Affordability, which basically said, listen, you got to get all these releases, all this. And so information does not flow between hospitals. I mean, your listeners should know this. You get tests over here. There's no way a doctor over here is going to see that. You have to bring them. And you're better off bringing them in paper format. I really think because paper allows someone to engage with paper and look at you. You can't engage over with a computer over here and be with the patient there. You can't. And so what patients complain about is, I went to the doctor. The doctor was over in the corner on the computer, and the doctor never looked me in the eye.
But the worst that I've seen ever is when you diagnose somebody and say, look, you have to go to the hospital. And you go to, say, University of Pennsylvania, wherever. And for 2 weeks, you get comfortable with this doctor. He's got your charts. You're talking to him. And then all of a sudden, a new set comes in that just asks you the same questions for 2 weeks that have no idea who you are. This is a major thing. I went through it for almost 2 years. This young girl had autoimmune disease out of nowhere. Mm. Just 18, bam, sick. And we had thought, like, just like, you know, didn't want to go to school or something. You know what I mean? Nope. You know, it kept going on, throwing up, wasn't eating, lost her hair, all this crazy shit. Long story short, it was attacking her liver, kidneys, whatever. Nobody could diagnose it. Mm. They said this, they said that, blah, 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 because there was no communication, like you said. Eventually took her to University of Pennsylvania, and then they were able to diagnose it as autoimmune disease. But this is 2 years of heart failure, kidney failure, dialysis for an 18-year-old kid just out of nowhere. It was wild. But I think it relates to no communication. Because every 2 weeks, whether it was Hershey Medical Center or the other one we went to and the other one, every 2 weeks it was somebody new coming in, asking questions. And then what had happened, say, in Hershey didn't get transferred. Not all of it got transferred to UPenn. And they were just like, what the hell with it? We're just going to do everything over again.
Well, that's the thing. Most of these upper-level centers are teaching centers. And it can't be the same person every time. It's always like a rotation. You know, when you fly in an airplane, it's not the same pilot every time.
Yeah.
It's always kind of a new crew. So people have to be fresh. There's the rotation. And so care becomes fragmented. You know, in the Midwest, our core to last appeals for a lot of places is the Mayo Clinic. You know, I like the Mayo Clinic up until COVID.
Yeah, that was the spot to go to read things.
Yeah, and now they've lost their mind. Now, I've given grand rounds at Mayo Clinic in the past. I mean, I've given a certificate, and you go to Mayo Clinic, and you know, they pick you up in a limo, drive you across the cornfields of Minnesota. And all of a sudden, out of the cornfields, you see these glass buildings coming up out of the ground, and it's the Mayo Clinic. And yeah, I met all these dignified people. They take you into one of the main buildings. It's all marble. There's these nice ladies giving like warm chocolate chip cookies, and and there's a guy playing a piano. And I was like,
I was fishing.
I feel better already. And but the Mayo Clinic, it does symbolize excellence. But I'll tell you one thing. They just repeat all the tests. Forget it. They're not going to rely on a single shred of information.
Good.
It's just everything is such a mess. And they figure, listen, we are the court of last appeals. We're starting from scratch. And you know, I have relied on Mayo Clinic for this. Medicine is all about second opinions. I hope everyone really understands this.
Yeah.
No two doctors agree on anything. No two lawyers agree on anything. No two podcasters agree on anything. We're not
right.
clones of each other.
Right.
So we always have different opinions. Now, you get a complex case like that girl's case of autoimmunity. Oh, man, you're going to get so many different opinions because the human body is complex. So we have to be tolerant, and we have to encourage multiple opinions. We have to encourage dialogue, because it's through all this vetting does truth emerge. In medicine, we actually don't hold the truth. There's no such thing as information or misinformation in medicine. It doesn't exist. It is, we're constantly using inferential thinking. Inferential thinking means we're making observations, and then we're inferring that, well, it's probably this, and we're trying to get closer and closer to truth, but we never really know. It's very different than deductive thinking. Deductive thinking is there is a law, and the law is absolute, and we rely on it. So there is a law of gravity. Well, we rely on it. That's how planes stay in the air. You know, we rely on various laws of physics, what have you. So deduction is very different than inferential thinking. And medicine is inferential thinking. So because of that, we always get a range of opinions. It ranges all the way from very broad-based epidemiology, which you know, I'm trained in that at University of Michigan, which is the study of the distribution and determinants of disease from large populations, all the way down to molecular biology. That, you know, we know a zinc molecule moves over here and inhibits the ribonuclease of a particular.
So one is more so an opinion, and the other would be a foundation, say.
Right. So in medicine, we do have laws. You mean we have various laws of acid-base balance that we can rely on. There are laws of thermodynamics. In cardiology, we rely on various principles of physics. You know, for instance, we rely on the Doppler principle. It's very important, which is the direction of blood flow and velocities. And
I think your IQ might be 220.
Yeah, he's pretty smart.
But in medicine, medicine is one of the coolest, funnest professions. You know, most doctors have no hobbies. You know why? Because we don't need one. Yeah. We have such an interesting field. If you ever go to these hospitals and go to Grand Rounds, which is our big, you know, weekly review of a particular case, there'll be doctors who are in their 90s coming in on walkers. It's like, why are you coming here? You're 90 years
they'll
old.
They'll be dead if they don't.
No, well
they got to keep going.
Right, partly they want to keep going, but partly because it's so interesting. A lot of these old doctors said, I remember when we didn't even know what this is. Now it's this. Or I remember when we had no effective treatment for this. I mean, let me give you an example. When I trained in medicine at the medical school level, I was at University of Texas Southwestern in Dallas. And so our hospital, our main teaching hospital is Parkland Memorial Hospital. Now, that's the hospital I took Kennedy to when he was shot in Dallas. And it's a storied, one of the largest, busiest, and probably one of the most famous public hospitals in the United States. Many things. I mean, the Nobel Prize has been awarded there at UT Southwestern and cholesterol metabolism and I think five other areas. Some of the critical things in OB-GYN and preeclampsia, for instance, work done at University of Texas Southwestern. A lot of things.
That's...
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So So at any rate, this idea that we could ultimately get to various levels of decisions based on information was born out of kind of crazy places like Parkland, where we ultimately had to put it together. And there was a famed chief of medicine there named Donald Selden, and he'd come from Yale. He still had this kind of Coney Island New York accent. And Donald Selden, when he came, said, you know, Dallas is a vast wasteland, an intellectual wasteland, and we need a university here. And, you know, Baylor School of Medicine was in Dallas, and it pulled out. MD Anderson was a philanthropist, pulled it out to Houston and formed the MD Anderson Texas Medical Center complex in Houston. So Dallas was without a medical center. So Baylor University Medical Center remained. The medical center remained, but there was no medical school. Still had the School of Nursing and Dentistry. But UT Southwestern came in. Donald Selden came to town, and boy, he really changed things.
Let things up, huh?
When I was a medical student, I'll never forget, he would do these rounds, and we were terrified of him because he was viewed to be a giant in medicine. And he had this, again, he had this Coney Island accent. And he'd always have some coins in his pocket. And he'd be walking up and down the aisles and representing a patient. And he could call in any one of us. We're like, oh, my gosh. We used to call him.
Don't tell me he walked around and jiggled the coins.
He jiggled the coins. He jiggled the coins. He was called.
What a night.
We called him the Don. He said, it's the Don. And so he goes, well, you know, in the setting of pituitary apoplexy, and this is when
While he's playing with his coins?
Yeah, he's playing with the coins. And you can imagine the pituitary just kind of gland just melting.
Yeah.
He goes, there is a sequence of loss of hormones in the plasma concentrations, and that sequence is exactly what? And he had arrived right at my, right where I was, and I just froze. I was like... I couldn't say anything. I was the Don had asked me a complicated question about the sequence of, and so then he was flipping the coins in his pocket, probably going a little bit slower. Yeah, in the coins, and then he puts his hand out of his pocket, and then he puts his hand on my head. He starts hitting my head like this, like
hello.
And I think I stumbled through the answer, but one of the notable things we remember about the Don. Is that he used to become so enraged, so there would be a presentation of a patient, and you know, because we have students, we have interns, we have residents and fellows, we have like a lot of layers of trainees. Anyhow, as someone was presenting the case, it turns out the person who was presenting the case was Gene Wilson. It turns out to be one of the editors later on of Harrison's Technical Internal Medicine. So Dr. Wilson became a big guy, but when he was a young guy. Selden looked at this chart, and back then we had paper charts. It was in green binders. He goes, this is a very imperceptive workup. He goes, this patient should be dead by now, because he was pointing out all the mistakes that were made. So he opens up the window on the ninth floor of Parkland, and he throws the chart out the window. And it's swirling around, and paper is going. But those were the days where we had no work restrictions. There was a lot of hazing in medicine,
but things got done.
There was unlimited work hours, and let me tell you what, we worked so hard. There's only 168 hours in the week, and I think there was a couple weeks. When I was in Dallas and then in Seattle, University of Washington, I think I was clocking 120. I mean, it was really hard. Now, right now, residents. My son's a resident in Pittsburgh. They are capped at 80. 80 is thought to be a light work week.
Wow.
They're capped at 80.
They capped them at 80.
At 80. And so nowadays, the old guys, oh, you young guys, you guys don't know how to work hard. You know, we work so hard. Because we literally just worked all day, all night, all the next day, get a break.
They did that down here with football. They capped. Yeah. You can't practice football in Florida if it's over, what, 100?
100.
His two sons play ball.
So
now imagine that.
But, you know, in medicine, it changed for a good reason. I'm actually in favor of the work restrictions. Well, the hazing went on, for instance. I'll tell you one other hazing thing. It would never happen nowadays.
Too bad.
I think it should happen. We were in the ICU, so we're all students, and there's some patient with a heart attack, and we're all around the bed. And our attending is James Willerson. He was the chief of cardiology. He later on would become the chief of medicine and really high up at Texas Medical Center in Houston. And he talked with a really soft voice, Jim Willerson. and we were presenting, we had the patient, and Dr. Willison said, "This patient's having a heart attack." And he pointed to my colleague.
Is that how he would talk to him?
He goes, "And Robbie, what does the EKG show?" And the student,
is that how he would really talk?
Yeah, the student was paralyzed, and he started stumbling, and so we're right over the bed. So the patient's leaving. So Willison reaches over the bed and grabs him by the tie and pulls him over, and he looks him right in the face. He goes, "You have to know the EKG on every single patient in your care in the CCU at all times. Is that clear?" He goes, "Yes." And then he pushes him back.
It was like.
Robbie never forgot the EKG ever again. Now, if that happened today, there would be a complaint.
Lawsuit.
That would go to the dean's office. Yeah. He strangulated him by the tie. Think about where we have come. This is amazing. When you were a kid growing up, was there a corporal punishment in school?
I never even heard the word.
Was there corporal punishment?
No. I don't know.
No, you guys haven't.
I never even heard of it.
When I grew up in Texas. Listen, I'm not that old. When I grew up in Texas, if one misbehaved, let's say if one, and I'm sure, knowing you, Tommy, I'm sure you've done this. You were in the cafeteria, you shot something at some kid and hit him in the head, you got reported to the principal's office, and then you smarted off to the principal.
Oh, you got the smack, right?
Okay. Let's say, okay, thank you very much, Tommy. We'll see you in the courtyard tomorrow at 8 o'clock. And so out in the courtyard, it would all be quiet. 8 o'clock. We're just starting class. Now, this happened when I was in high school in Texas. Two different high schools, for sure. Really quiet. The paddle comes out, and the paddle is like a giant waffle board about this big, and it's heavy. And then you pull down your pants, and they absolutely wail on this kid hard.
My dad talked about that.
And just smack, smack, smack. Screaming, and we could all hear it saying, "Oh, that's so bad. He's really bad. He's and people would count how many.
How many times?
My co-author on my book, John Leake. Yeah. John is apparently
our buddy.
He's the record holder for Highland Park High School number of waffle fanny paddles.
Why can I believe that? I text with John.
John's kind of a, do you know where he is right now?
Where is
he's
he
out in Maui in Lahaina. Oh, he's boy. Investigating the fire.
Is he, I thought he went out to have a good time.
Well, he will too. John's
a funny guy.
He's a man of mystery and intrigue. If anybody's cool. Like James Bond, it's like John Leake. Anyhow, he actually set the record for the number of fanny paddles. But here's my point. Just like the tie incident would be automatic hazing, lawsuit, what have you. Any child today that's even touched, would be personal assault. And so the point I'm making is for hundreds and hundreds of years, let's say in Texas in the deep South, corporal punishment was a standard in families and in schools. Whether you think it's good or bad, it was a standard. And look in our generation how quickly standards have changed.
Yeah.
So we've gone from corporal punishment to it's breaking the law. We've gone from paper and pencil to everything's on an iPhone. We've gone, just think about our generation is up there. There may be some other generations that are close, but we're up there with the most versatile sets of generations that had to deal with the most changes, not only consumer electronics, but also socially, culturally. And look at what we're dealing with now with transgender.
Yes.
A disaster.
Did they worry about transgender back in 1870?
Never even heard of it. Never even
spoken
of. How
about 1920?
Never even spoken of.
1970?
How about 1990?
How about
2000? Never even heard of it in 1990.
Wow, another paper is going to come out of my Substack. I put it up last night on the plane because I work all the time. Listen to this. From 2016 to 2020, the number of transgender surgeries more than doubled. And we're not just talking about breast implants. We are talking about everything, including the dreaded penile inversion vaginoplasty.
Mm-hmm. I heard.
Rob, have you heard of that?
Yeah. We had Jovan Poltran, who they also tried to kill him. Seven guys have been in the trial. I always know if somebody doesn't open a bottle of water. He invented the QR code. To make a very long story short, that same guy then invented a cell phone case where if you touched it, it would tell you if you have one cancer cell
You pick up your phone, it would notify you, you have one cancer cell. That way you could go to a doctor right away and say, hey, I have a cancer cell. Can you look at this and to get it right away? Because he which you know, I'm sure, or is accurate, that more people die from radiation and chemo than the actual cancer. You would know if that's true or not better than me. That's what he was saying. But he's also trying to get a patent passed. But you would touch it, and it would tell you if you had any cancer cells. So all his other he has more patents than anybody in the planet. But this one wouldn't go through. Like, parts wouldn't want. Long story short, he testifies with the Senate. Whatever he said there about his thing, Big Pharma didn't like it. He's at a TED conference. Mm-hmm. They come in to bring him food. He eats his food. Then some weird look at people bring him food. It looks weird, but he just eats it, not thinking anything. We're talking about a patent here. He eats it, what was it, five people?
Mm-hmm.
He was in the hospital 3 months. Then they tried to shoot up his house. He had to move.
Crazy shit.
The other three people that were with him, I think one died.
One or two, I think.
One or two died.
Is this a real story?
Yeah, no, this is 100% real.
When did this happen?
Jovan Paul, maybe a year ago?
No, longer than that, I think.
Maybe a year and a half? Yeah. This episode is brought to you by Let's Get Checked. Are you the man your father was? Recent studies have shown that men's testosterone levels have dropped substantially since the 1980s at about an average of 1% per year. Think about how old your father was when he was born. For example, if he was 30, your testosterone levels could be 30% lower than his. Low testosterone levels can have all type of health effects on men. It can affect your mood, sex drive, memory, muscle mass loss, you name it. And yes, low testosterone is more common the older you get, but it can affect men at any age. So let's talk about today's sponsor, Let's Get Checked. You can order a testing kit that will be delivered to you in a discreet packaging with next day delivery. Once your sample arrives in the laboratory, confidential results will be available from your secure online account within 2 to 5 days. So, if you want to test your hormone levels without having to leave your home, visit trylgc.com/MSCSmedia and get 25% off your test using the code MSCSmedia. The link is in the description at the top. This episode is sponsored by Blue Chew. Let's talk about sex. Guys, remember the days when you're always ready to go? Now you can increase your performance and get that extra confidence in bed. Listen up, BlueChew.com. Blue Chew is a unique online service that delivers the same active ingredients as Viagra, Cialis, and Levitra, but in chewable tablets at a fraction of the cost. You can take them anytime, day or night, so you can plan ahead or be ready whenever the opportunity arises. The process is simple. Sign up at BlueChew.com, consult with one of their licensed medical providers, and once you're approved, you'll receive your prescription within days. The best part? It's all done online. So no visits to the doctor's office, awkward conversations, waiting in line at the pharmacy. Blue Chew's tablets are made in the USA and prepared and shipped direct to your door in a discreet package. Does it work? Don't think you need it? Try it free for a month and see. You're going to love it. You could be missing the best sex of your life. They say there's nothing sexier than confidence, and Blue Chew can help give you the confidence where it counts. Blue Chew wants to help you have better sex. Discover your options at BlueChew.com. Chew it and do it. And we've got a special deal for our listeners. Try Blue Chew free when you use the promo code MSCS at checkout. Just pay $5 shipping. That's BlueChew.com, promo code MSCS, to receive your first month free. Visit BlueChew.com for more details and important safety information. We thank Blue Chew for sponsoring the podcast.
Yeah, probably.
He was telling a story.
Well, think about in life how many times people serve you. Like, listen, I trusted you that this coffee was okay.
Yeah.
We didn't put anything in it this time.
Yeah, well, listen.
What was my point about Joe?
But think about this. I'm going to get on the plane. You guys were nice enough to get me first class. I want your audience to know, first class for Tommy. Come down here. First class. I didn't get first class with Rogan. Or these other guys? You kidding? First, I've set all the records on Rogan. But you fly in first class. Think about
you
that.
Did so.
They said, oh, listen, 2F, they actually know where the food is going. Listen, 2F, that guy is kind of going against the government narrative. Why don't we give him a little sprinkle on his tray?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are vulnerable.
That's exactly what they did with them.
Yeah.
Oh, man, did you see the dissident Russian that got shot down yesterday?
Yeah.
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 Plane.
Boom.
Boom.
I think, gone. But I saw the video.
His wing fell off, right?
Oh, he's gone.
No, I know, but it looked like it was a shoot down.
Yeah.
Did you see it?
No, I just heard that the wing came off.
Yeah, see if you could pull it off.
It looks like something comes from the ground up, nails it, and when it goes down, it's not like if an engine went down, the plane just kind of generally struggles down. This is a straight down. This is nose down, straight
like
down.
Like engine, everything shut
What's
off.
What's his name? Yevgeny?
We'll find it.
Prigozhin. Prigozhin.
Okay, Prigozhin. Prigozhin. So Prigozhin. He leads this Wagner group, which is going to kind of go against Putin.
Oh,
and what all the pundits were saying yesterday on the news is they were saying, listen, you don't go against Putin and get away with it. You may live a little bit longer, but he'll find a way and smoke him.
I don't know why they keep underestimating Putin. I don't get it. I don't think he's slow. I think he's smart.
Have you ever been to Russia?
I have not.
Oh, Tommy.
But I have a very good friend who came from Russia, you know, the right way. His name's Lenny. Doesn't do anything wrong, you know. Well, you know, made a few mistakes. That's a funny story I'll tell you one day with this guy Lenny. But Russia guy, real good friend of mine, and he loves it there. He loves it there and here.
Well, I tell you, I went to Russia twice, and one of the most impressive things is to go to Moscow and go to the Politburo. Okay, is this a shoot down?
Yeah. Is this
is the one I could find that they have the plane going down. So let's
just be warned that the following video is pretty graphic. It is unverified footage of
the plane that
crashed, which had Wagner chief Yevgeny.
Okay, Prigozhin, what's going down there?
Footage of the private jet.
It's going straight down.
Something shoots first, though. It
is
Rob.
Okay, let me see if I can find that. I don't see one with crashed, that part, but this is when it's coming down.
There's some guy in his backyard, and he nails it. I thought I saw something shooting.
I'll look it, see if I can find it.
But here's the point. Everybody was on the news saying, listen, you know, one of two things. Either he was on the plane and he's finished, or two, he just faked his name on the plane and now he's making his big escape. And the thing is, you'll never know.
Never know.
Right? This is like a Tom Clancy novel, right?
Yeah.
Tom Clancy, Cardinal in the Kremlin and what have you. But anyhow, so I went to Russia a few times. I've lectured in Moscow. But we had a chance to go to Politburo, where they vote. And you'll see the vote in the Politburo. It's 3,250 to zero. There is no disagreement on this legislation. None. And now here's the next thing they voted on. Oh, no disagreement there. And so it keeps going and going. And my point is, we better watch it because we're heading there too. If we had a vote right now, who's going to vote on more vaccines? You know, the powers that be, they want it 100% take more shots and they don't want any disagreement. And if any doctor disagrees with it, watch out.
Look what happened with Kirk. Dr. Kirk, he was a plastic surgeon, one of the top breast guys. I had him on. They fucking indicted him because he took your proctor. I believe he talked to you, Dr. Kirk Moore.
Kirk, I know him.
Yeah, I had him on trying to help him out with the donations. And, you know, whatever the situation is, you know, according to him, it's the first time that the government got in between doctor-patient relation. And if he's found, you know, if he doesn't beat that, jeez, that gets an entire standard. Now you have the doctor. Do I make this decision and maybe get indicted, but I know it's wrong, right? Or do I make the right decision and risk indictment, or do I go with what they want? Medically, I know this is probably not right, but I'm not going to get indicted. I mean, that becomes a real problem.
Listen, Canada's got over 1,000 doctors sitting on the sidelines that have been nailed. I was in kind of semi-court for the College of Physicians and Surgeons for Dr. Mark Trousy, and they really tried to beat me up. There was this lawyer, and she had the most severe hairdo. You know, have you ever seen the women that pull their hair back in a bun that's so tight?
It just feels like pulls her eyebrows back.
Yeah, she's looking like.
And then they spray it down.
Yeah, and she just wanted to kill me. And she goes, and Dr. McCullough, I want to bring up evidence 172.6.3.5. And it's a video clip. And she says, what is this? I said, well, it's a video clip. And then she goes, well, and then what's the marker say in the left-hand corner? I says, well, it says 46 minutes and 20. And so it was just this technical beatdown.
Bold.
And I said, ma'am, I said, there are 16 million hits on me on the internet. There are thousands upon thousands of videos, maybe tens of thousands of videos. I've actually given more media and more clips and more analyses than anybody in the world. I said, so if you pick another video, yes, it's me, and yes, that's what I've said. And if you have any questions about this doctor who's been screwed out of his license for a year, let's get on to it. And she kept just like she was going to incriminate
31, 26,
me.
31, 26, 34.
And she kept like she was going to incriminate me, and she went through this severe, prosecutorial thing, and she was going to, in the U.S. courts, we call it Delberting. You ever heard of Delbert?
Yeah, I heard.
Delbert is like, you know, you're not qualified. But they couldn't Delbert me out. They kept fighting. Great attorney for Trousey, which is Mike Alexander. He thinks he's going to go to the Supreme Court. Couldn't get rid of me. Finally asked me a couple questions.
Actual questions.
Yeah, actual questions. And the actual questions are, I said, yeah, I looked at that. This shows the vaccines don't work. And yeah, I've looked at that. It shows the vaccines cause this problem. And she was like, you know, I have no more questions. And so she wanted to get up. But this guy's been screwed out of his license now for 2 years. They got about 1,000 doctors like that. France has got about 2,000. Australia, 1,000. New Zealand, where the doctor said, listen, I'm not going to take this shot. I'm not going to force it on my patients. I'm going to treat my patients with COVID, including ivermectin. Oh, my gosh. Have you seen that one lately about the FDA being sued about its ivermectin statements?
Oh, because they had run out of it? They said they were out of it?
No.
What's this one?
No, this is really good. This is Dr. Mary Talley Bowden in Houston, Robert Apter in Arizona, and Paul Merrick in Virginia. And they said, we're suing the FDA. The FDA said during the heat of the pandemic that ivermectin is only horse paste.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they put out a tweet. It said, come on, y'all, stop it. And so they sued him. They said, you can't mislead the country like this. Ivermectin is a human drug. We found it useful in COVID. It's community standard of care. Doctors determine this community standard of care, not FDA. And they sued the FDA. In the first round of it, they got dismissed. So they appealed it. Now they're back in appeal court. They finally got the FDA, you know, on their heels. And when it came down to it, the attorney for the FDA, who's a woman, she said, FDA never said doctors couldn't use ivermectin. It's like, oh, really? I mean, doctors lost their licenses over this and what have you? And we said, what about this tweet where it shows the horse? And she goes, oh, that was just a quip.
What the hell? What's a quip?
A quip is just a flippant type of statement. Oh, like a quip cost people their lives? So the FDA's been
suddenly was out of stock?
The FDA was slammed on this. And governments all over the world are going to be slammed on this because it's an example of what you said, Tommy. It's the government interfering in the doctor-patient relationship. What the doctor finds to be useful in a patient is the community standard of care. The doctors determine this, not the government. And not the pharmaceutical companies, doctors.
Mm-hmm.
And this interference in the standard of care in early treatment of COVID cost lives, many lives. I estimate now we lost 2/3 of 1.2 million lives because we weren't able to treat them properly early. And people were denied treatment. And the treatments were hard to get and denied. And that 2/3 of 6 million hospitalizations could have been avoided. This is a tragedy of unbelievable proportions. It's in our book, Courage to Face COVID-19. Yeah, by the way, the book is doing really good. Well, it's up on the screen. The book's
we'll pull the actual tab up.
The book is doing great. You know, it's a 5-star Amazon bestseller. It reads very, very quickly. John Leake's a terrific author. He's the man of intrigue.
He was in with you last time.
By the way, girls, single. He's probably the coolest, hottest single guy out there, John Leake.
He's Johnny Depp when he was younger.
He's like Johnny Depp. Yeah, he's like semi-pro in everything. Did I tell you that? He's a semi-pro surfer, semi-pro boxer.
Is he?
He's just semi-pro in everything.
Yeah, I talked to him about it.
Like, how do you do that? How are you semi-pro?
Surfer and boxer, that's cool, two mixes.
So he knows about how to jab, and he's out there surfing. But he is a pro writer, so he's probably considered right now the world's greatest historian living, really. And his range is amazing.
And hilarious.
And he's hilarious, and he's a lot of fun. But the point is, you know what they're talking about now? John's talking about major motion picture.
Really?
Yes. Oh,
there you go, buddy.
So someone's going to play me, Tom.
Don't forget about the little guy over here when it comes
out.
We're
going to get you in.
So who would you have play you?
I don't know.
Brad Pitt?
No. Yeah, I got to get somebody. I got this back problem I'm struggling with.
Bradley Cooper.
This kyphosis. So there's been some discussion of actually Kevin Costner, believe it or not.
Kevin, yeah, let's go, Peter.
Yeah.
He's about 8 years older than me, so we'll see. But I said, you know, I'm boring. It's not like, you know, I'm not like James Bond. There's no scenes where I was jumping across buildings or anything. I'm just a doctor. I'm just trying to help people. It's not
that
exciting.
Yeah, but the shit you've been through?
Yeah.
When you really should have a trophy, like, hanging around your office and everything instead of lawsuits?
Yeah, can you believe that there's a physician email, a bunch of physician email services. One is Medscape and MedAdvisor and Heart.org and these other ones. Do you know one of them floated out? They floated out the 2021 top 20 worst doctors in America. And the first doctor was in an orange suit, and he was obviously a criminal, and he'd done horrible things. And the second one was a drug abuser. And the third one beat up his patients, whatever you. And I'm listed on the back half of this group. And there I am. Like, what I do? I just treated COVID patients. I mean, I'm listed in the top 20.
And you're the one that the pros are contacting, you know, that don't want to take it. Speaking of which, now this is what gets me. Okay, now this is me saying this. Jamie Foxx, I think, is from the shot. Okay, of course, they'll bury that forever. But LeBron James, this is what gets me the most. His son, Bronny, you know, had the best trainers in the planet, the best nutritionist in the planet, the best everything in the planet. The kid's about to go pro. Best shape probably of anyone. LeBron James is his son, genetic freak. At 18, has a heart attack and falls over. And probably if it wasn't LeBron James' kid, would he have made it with everything? Now, if you're LeBron James, even though you were an advocate for the vaccine, this is your son now. Don't you think it's time to come out and be like, hey, I'm LeBron James. My son almost died because I have $500 million from Nike. I have the best of everything and I saved him. But that shot gave my kid this heart attack. How do you not do that? Or do you think he actually thinks it's not from that?
Okay, so while we're taking on Bronny James, Rob, here's a new assignment.
And the football guy.
Bring up me and Jamie Foxx. You'll find it on Twitter.
You and Jamie?
Yeah, we took pictures together. So you'll see with Dr. McCullough, Jamie Foxx. Okay, so let's deal with Bronny James. Bronny James went to a private high school that absolutely mandated the vaccines with no exceptions. Okay. LeBron James, in September of 2021, comes out and says, I've researched this carefully and I've decided the vaccine is the best for me and my family. We're going to take the vaccine. That's September of 2021. Now, June of 2021, the FDA says the vaccines cause heart damage, myocarditis. Let me tell you, before COVID, we never let athletes work out or compete with myocarditis because it triggers a cardiac arrest. I mean, this is before COVID. This is standard operating principles.
Which then explains the NFL, Ronnie,
right.
The soccer players.
So what type of research did he do? Who did he call? So we'll get to that in a second.
Yeah, he is in California.
So then LeBron ostensibly takes the shots. His family takes the shots. USC is also mandating the shots. So last year, Bronny James' teammate, Uwachuku, you probably can find him too on a separate tab, Rob, Uwachuku, has a cardiac arrest last year.
Wow.
So one of Bronny James' teammates had a cardiac arrest. So on USC Trojans basketball team. So Uwachuku survives, and he gets an ICD. Presumably they're getting what's now called the subcutaneous ICD. So they're not implantable cardio defibrillators. They're not ones that go in the bloodstream where they could pull out by lifting the arm. They're actually implanted just under the chest muscle, and they would sense an arrest and then shock the heart. So Bronny James should know that, wow, one of his teammates had a cardiac arrest. Bronny James, I don't think, had a full cardiac arrest because he was in and out of the ICU like in a matter of hours, home the next day. So it wasn't a full cardiac arrest. But you think, they come forward, the answer is, Vince Uwachuku. So just stay there for a second. So what we know is that USC now, as a basketball team, has had two cardiac arrests. There have been headlines saying, wow, they're in good practice now. They know where the defibrillator is. They know where to find it. We know now that these cardiac arrests in athletes for sure are due to the vaccines. And you know when it's not due to the vaccine, you know why? Because the first thing they'll come out and say, I didn't take the vaccine.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This, by the way, this happened. There was a kid in out west somewhere where there was a report, a 6-foot blood clot was in this kid, a really tall kid, a 6-foot blood clot they pulled out of his veins. Wow. And everyone goes, he took the vax, he took the vax. They were tweeting this. The mother right away, no, everybody, he didn't take the vax. He's got an abnormality, his inferior vena cava. He's got a vascular abnormality, and that's the reason why the blood clotted there. So the mother, I texted the mother. I said, thank you for clarifying that. If people would just clarify. But when they're silent,
you
assume that they took the vax, especially when the dad says they're vaccine and the school says they're vaccine. Right. Assume they take the vax and assume these cardiac arrests are due to myocarditis. And the concern here is Vince does the right thing. Iwichukwu does the right thing. He gets a defibrillator because if he has another arrest, the defibrillator is going to pop him. Okay. Now, by the way, I had a chance to, while we're on this topic, I had a chance to talk to pilot Bob Snow. Do you know the story about Bob Snow?
Is that the one that flew by the White House and he went out?
No, this guy, Bob Snow, is a very senior American Airlines pilot. He lands a big plane at DFW Airport, pulls up to the jet bridge. People are getting off. He has a cardiac arrest. And I talked to him. He goes, listen, he goes, it's lights out. He goes, there's no chance. You know, I couldn't put out my hands. It's just as if somebody turned off. Have you seen these cardiac arrests when they go down? I mean, they just go down. It's a total face plant.
Bunch of taxi car guys.
So anyhow, Snow does a face plant. And I wrote a Substack on this called The Miracle of Pilot Snow. Here's the miracle. So pretty much everybody's off the plane. Now, do you know on almost every airplane there's a doctor? By chance, there always is. So everyone's gone. So they can't say, is there a doctor on the plane? Everyone's gone, so they're already out. So they started panicking in the jetway. Somebody, you know, start doing CPR, and somebody on their cell phone calls 911. Here's the miracle. DFW has got actually its own EMS system for the airport because it's a big airport. By chance, the paramedics are at the next gate dealing with some old lady who had some problem or what have you, and they literally just had to run right over. Like literally one gate to another at DFW Airport. They're right there. They get there, and he's in full cardiac arrest. They have to shock him 3 times. So that tells you he's pretty deep into it. But they pop him. They get him out of it. They put him on the life support, take him to a Dallas hospital. When he gets up and he gets off all the tubes and everything, he does a video. He goes, this is what the vaccine did to me. I took the vaccine. I had a cardiac arrest 2 months later. So anyhow, he gets a subcutaneous ICD, I think how this guy had it in Iwichukwu. And so I catch up with him at a meeting. I said, pilot, it's great to see you. How are you doing? He goes, why don't you check out my ICD? And he showed me. So the unit is up under the latissimus dorsi here. It goes up under the pectoralis muscle. He goes, yeah, I can work out. I can do everything. He goes, I can't fly anymore, but I can work out. So this is interesting. It's about 2 years after his cardiac arrest. I said, has it ever gone off? Has the device actually, have you had a second arrest? He goes, nothing.
Nothing.
Not so lucky as the case of Adamus. Why don't you bring him up? Oscar Cabrero Adamus. Oh, gosh.
What's that?
This is a bad.
They bury everything.
Heard of him?
No, they bury everything.
Oh, my gosh. This guy is Dominican. He plays in the international leagues. He's a basketball player. Oscar Cabrero Adamus. That's him. He's playing. In 2021, he has the cardiac arrest. He does. Yeah, pull that up. He does the face plant. He does the face plant right in 2021. Down. Full cardiac arrest. They do CPR. They save him. By the way, in these athlete cardiac arrests, because there's a whole bunch of people there, about a third of them they can save. Two-thirds they die. So Damar Hamlin, Bronny James, Iwichukwu, they save him, right? This guy gets saved. Adamus gets saved. And you know what happens is he tweets out. He goes, I got myocarditis from the vaccines. So Adamus
I got
myocarditis from the effing vaccine.
I got two doses of Pfizer.
Two doses of Pfizer. He got myocarditis. Listen, he sits out, Tommy, he sits out for 2 years, and he's trying to get treatment. I'm sure he's seeing someone like me. I'm giving the medications. But he decides probably not to get the defibrillator. And then look what happens. Scroll back up, Rob. Look what happens. He goes on this treadmill. Just go ahead and play this clip. This will tell what's going on.
Attack while allegedly undergoing a stress test. Cabrera is believed to have suffered from myocarditis.
That's his first arrest right there. American Boom.
Heart Association, that disease Down. Can weaken the heart and its electrical system and decreases the heart's ability to pump blood. Following his death, social media posts surfaced in which Cabrera suggested he developed the rare heart disease after he received two doses of a COVID vaccine. He also said the vaccine
he
was
died
a
on this trip.
Requirement. He fainted and collapsed during a 2021 Spanish
looks like he's in pretty good shape.
So you can turn that off. So he dies on the treadmill in 2023. Now, listen, I'm a cardiologist. I supervise treadmill tests. I've never had someone die in a treadmill test. I've had cardiac arrest, but we can shock the heart. We can get IVs in. We can do everything. It must have been a brutal cardiac arrest that this guy dies. But here's the point. Vaccine in 2021, myocarditis, an arrest in 2021, and he dies in 2023 on a supervised treadmill test. Mm. Look at all these people now. Bronny James, Damar Hamlin, all the European athletes. What in the world? If these guys don't get defibrillators, more people are going to go down.
So, is it the money? Is that why they're not coming out and saying anything? Because they're afraid they're going to lose endorsement money, agenda money? Is this about money that they're not coming out, especially like a LeBron? Or does he not believe it?
To find an answer to that question, Tommy,
you know,
I had to, and you have to do this sometimes, Rob, I had to do a Twitter poll. And you got to get the answer. I did a poll. I said, what is going on with all these public figures? What's the answer? You know what the answer is?
Well, I can't wait to hear this.
The answer is they're afraid they're going to lose more.
More.
So they've already lost a lot. They're afraid if they're going to come out, they're going to lose more. Now bring up Jamie Foxx. More. Jamie Foxx is, I think, the best example of this. Bring up Jamie if you still have it, Rob. I was at a Cowboys game in 2021, and I'm in a nice suite and stuff, and Jamie Foxx and his entourage comes up and say, hey, we want to talk to you. So, I meet with Jamie Foxx, and there's pictures.
There's a picture. Right, let me see if I can find the video.
So, we have a private conversation. It's a private conversation, but you can imagine Jamie got the lowdown of what I think on the vaccines, and that is they're not safe. So what I'm telling you is Jamie Foxx knew the vaccines weren't safe. Okay? So if you can't find it, that's okay. So, there it is right there.
Oh, there he is.
Yeah, so there we are. So,
congratulations.
You probably won't. It won't come up. Just go back to the screen. So, so there you are. So I took a picture with Jamie Foxx. He's a good guy. We met my wife. And let me tell you what. Now, he's 5 years younger than me. He is a stud. He is in shape, and he's fit, and he's smart.
Talented.
Very talented. Yeah. I mean, you've seen the stuff he's done. Remember,
acting.
Yeah. Remember he played the he played the boxer?
Boxer.
This guy's, amazing this guy's got it.
Yeah.
Okay, he is not the guy who's going to have a stroke or heart attack. So what Hollywood reporter A.J. Benza, who apparently knows the scoop, he's in reported. Foxx has not communicated with me after this. But what Benza says is, listen, he got to the point where there's another movie. They said, take a shot. He knows it's not safe. He takes a shot. And what Benza reports is he has a stroke.
Yeah.
And he's in the hospital for months. We don't hear about him. People are like, what about his movie? Finally, after months, he comes out with a video statement. He's lost a ton of weight. I don't know if you can find the video.
Yeah,
he lost a ton of weight. He looks very pale. He's anemic. The left side of his face now has changed. So you can tell that there's been a stroke. Now, he doesn't say the word stroke, but everyone else says he's had a stroke, right? Have you? And he says, I've been through hell and back. He goes, I didn't want people to see me with tubes in me. Tubes. Let me tell you, if someone's had a stroke and they have tubes in them, let me tell you the tubes they have. They have a feeding tube into their stomach because they can't swallow. And they're on the ventilator, and they have a tracheostomy tube. And if you look at that video where he gives the video.
Oh, look how skinny. Wow, that's skinny.
Yeah, that one on the right there.
Yeah, the one on the right.
Yeah, that one on the right.
Scroll down, Rob.
You click on that.
Yeah, okay. Click on the Yahoo News for that one. Yeah.
Okay, ooh. No, but there's one, the video. See, look at his left side of his face is now, the fold is not the same on the left side of his face. And he's lost a tremendous amount of weight. He's anemic. And that's the video.
Oh my gosh.
That's the video. And look where his shirt is. Yeah. His shirt is buttoned up, I think, to cover up where the tracheostomy tube was. Right. So I texted out, when this happened, you know, it's terrible when this happened. We don't want anybody to go through this. I texted him out. I tweeted out. I said, hey, Jamie, praying for you. I said, I hope you held strong on what we talked about.
Yeah.
I mean, look at Novak Djokovic.
I know.
World's greatest tennis player. And the guy asked him, he said, are you willing to give up being known in history as the world's greatest tennis player? He goes, yeah, I am. Hmm. Look at Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah.
Aaron says, listen, I'm not going to take it. Look at Joe Rogan. Look at me. Look at you.
I guess my question is for people out there, kids especially, because I know some people, I have a friend, he lives with doubt, or not doubt, but he's upset that he had his kids get the vaccine. Is there a light at the end of the tunnel? Like, what can you do if your kids have gotten this vaccine and now you're seeing all this? Is there a solution? Is there an antidote? Is there something?
Right. But first off, let's just talk about, bring up that tab about why the vaccines go to the heart. This is really important.
You got that tab, bro? Yeah,
I think everybody could deal with this if the heart wasn't involved, right? Because you need the old ticker.
But just real quick, back to these guys. Is it all about the money?
They're afraid they're going to lose more.
Unlike Ice Cube, who you have to give respect to, he turned down $9 million.
Yeah, I was like $9 or $10 million. Ice Cube, told Tucker, right? Yeah. Oh, did you see when Tucker asked one of the Republican candidates, what Tucker said, well, how many vaccines did you take? And then he goes, well, Tucker, how many did you take? And he goes, none. Everyone goes, yeah.
Yeah.
Because when I went on Tucker's long program, that was his breakout interview. He had never, he actually freaked out. He gave me his, wrote down a paper, here's my cell phone number, text me. And, he basically told me, he goes, I'll never take that effing stuff. So, I knew Tucker was going to hold strong through this whole thing.
And anybody who believes that there's an actual $700 million defamation suit for something somebody said needs to go get mental help. Because they said they had to release him because of a defamation suit. And they paid $700 million, Peter? Yeah,
right, for voter boxes or something.
$700 million?
Yeah. But the question was, listen, I was in the Highwire studio. And this guy is really smart. This is Gert Vandenbosch. He used to work for Gates Foundation. He worked for all the major pharmaceuticals. And he flies all the way over here from Belgium. He meets me and Del Bigtree. And we get to load up questions on each other, right? So this is kind of, he's a heavy hitter. So let's listen to the question he asked me and how I answered it. This is pretty good.
Real quick on Del. I had Del in, and he had all those charts. And, you know, I can move things on YouTube to make sure they can't kick it down. That chart I thought would be okay. They called the chart and kicked it down.
Oh,
suspended me for 2 weeks, fucking Dell.
Oh, man.
But it was my fault. I missed it. I didn't see the line of code to move it.
You know, women love him.
What? I know.
My wife says he's just so handsome. His hair is everything about Dell is a great guy. Okay, let's see it.
Well, maybe it was because he was next to what's his name for somebody else.
According to your experience, that we are primarily, not exclusively, of course, but primarily seeing all these problems in the heart. Of course, we are all also seeing a number of problems with other organs. The number, for example, of diabetes cases, of course, not due to the vaccine, so to say, but have gone up. We see people struggling with other organs, etc. Why is it so pronounced in the myocarditis? I mean, why is primarily the heart so strongly affected? Is it because of the blood circulation that is so?
Well, many organs can tolerate some inflammation and it's relatively silent. The liver, the spleen. Mm. Now the brain can't tolerate much because it evokes symptoms, and neither can the heart.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's an array. We talked about cardiac arrest, ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation. There's also atrial fibrillation. The most common heart rhythm has been linked to this. Clearly, a progression of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, plaque rupture, myocardial infarction, that's been linked to the vaccines and inflammation, as well as vascular disasters like aortic dissection. Mm-hmm. So this is all in the peer-reviewed literature. But the heart uniquely receives its blood flow primarily in diastole, so the resting phase.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not systolically punching through. And not only that, but myocardial blood flow is dynamic. So at rest, our myocardial blood flow is at a baseline. When we exercise,
you know, we can have a 2-4-fold increased risk of myocardial blood flow. Paper by Castriuta and colleagues has demonstrated circulation of the messenger RNA for at least a month after one of these shots. What do the athletes do? They take a shot and they go exercise, they're working out. So constantly think about juicing myocardial blood flow, more deposition of vaccine material into the heart. It's taken up. Paper by Avolio and colleagues showed the pericytes, the support cells in the heart, the ones take it up more avidly than others. They translate the messenger RNA, is largely what we're talking about. The spike protein is expressed on the cell surface of these pericytes. They're in close proximity to the capillaries. The body's immune system reacts to it. Dr. Van de Bosch can tell us that, you know, for the first time, instead of something that's part of the major histocompatibility complex on the surface of the cell, now we're expressing the Wuhan spike protein. Yeah. The human body's going to say, wait a minute, what is this? And so there's going to be an attack. A paper by Bowmeyer and colleagues took biopsies of young men who were in the hospital suffering with vaccine myocarditis, and there were clearly zones of inflammation, and the spike protein was right there. Schwab showed the fatal cases is right there.
So one of the arguments would be that, you know, the only thing that's happening in the heart, as Paul Offit has said, which is sort of what we've talked about, it's seeing the heart, it's seeing the spike protein, it's creating antibodies, and there's antibodies that there's the heart has self cells that look like the spike, and therefore the antibodies are attacking the heart. But you're saying, no, it's just the spike protein being expressed by cells in the heart that are coming under attack by the immune system?
There's also a wrinkle from, in a paper from Massachusetts General Hospital, this is very important, where kids were in the hospital, myocarditis, and they were measured both spike protein in the blood and neutralizing antibodies. And the kids with myocarditis had circulating spike protein, but the antibodies were not neutralizing the spike. The kids without myocarditis had spike, but the antibodies were correctly neutralizing it. So there may be what you're talking about, the immune system now is missing. Well.
But here's the point. That's, you know, we need to talk. That's an example of, you know, people in the medical field talking. When was the last time we've seen that on CNN or MSNBC?
How about anywhere?
Anywhere. I mean, this is a brand new vaccine. COVID-19 is a brand new illness. We should have the most dialogue, the most interchange. And citing the literature, you can see, you know, Highwire does a good job. When we cite the literature, they find it. And they source it. And what people have learned over time is they have Dr. McCullough on, it's the real deal. I'm not going to showboat this at all. Every single case, it's going to be, you find it. You know, there's nothing that's going to be outside the realm of the peer-reviewed literature. So.
And then how do they go from, okay, there's no more ivermectin, suddenly it's out of stock, it's horse deworm or whatever, okay, you can't do that, blah, blah, blah. Then somehow the FDA mandates Pfizer to release the documents. We had Amy Kelly on, and she had all that stuff, which I never even saw it anywhere on social media, news. I was like, wow, and how different batches. And Rob had made the joke, which kind of seems to possibly be real, that if the driver stopped to get gas and one of the batches got warm, then, you know, that batch number would have a lesser side effect. But let's just say an athlete who's got a gazillion dollars, that batch is going right to that doctor, no stop, full potency. So then she had that chart where you could say, hey, doc, what batch did you try to kill me with? And then you could type it in and see, you know, what you're looking at. This episode is brought to you by Fiji. More than just water.
This is not just rock. It's ancient volcanic rock that filters tropical rain, giving it double the electrolytes and its signature soft, smooth taste. It's not just water, it's Fiji water.
This episode is brought to you by Manscaped.com. Breaking news, Manscaped now sells beard products. That's right, they are once again revolutionizing men's grooming with brand new Beard Hedger Pro Kit. From a beard trim to a fresh shave, the technology behind Beard Hedger Pro Kit allows you to shave your signature beard look. Now you can finally use Manscaped products to make your drapes match your carpet by going to manscaped.com and using code MSCSMedia for 20% off and free shipping. No one likes a weird beard, so say goodbye to all the stubble trouble with Manscaped's Pro Beard Kit. It all starts with the beard hedger. This thing is a monster of fixing faces. First off, this cordless trimmer has a rotary wheel that gives you 20 hair cutting lengths all with one guard. No more messing around in drawers, this color one, that color one, all with one guard. Plus, it's waterproof, so you can shave in the shower and avoid all that hair in the sink. The pro kit doesn't end there, though. First, there's the beard shampoo and conditioner. You need to remember, your hair is different. Next, Manscaped's beard oil. Cap it off with beard balm. The pro kit also comes with three different gifts: a beard brush, comb, and scissors to ensure your beard is ready to impress. So get 20% off and free shipping with the code MSCSMedia at manscaped.com. That's 20% off and free shipping at manscaped.com. Use the code MSCSMedia.
So Rob's question. So,
but I'm saying, how did they get the FDA to mandate that?
Yeah, well, Rob was saying, well, what can we do?
Yeah.
First thing is, let's take the knowledge base. So there's a paper by Schmeling and colleagues from Denmark. This is the best paper by far. They had all Pfizer side effects. They knew the batches. So there's three batch groups. Just under a third of the batches, zero side effects. None. Not even a sore arm. This is very important. Not even a sore arm. So people listening out there who took a shot, they had nothing. They had nothing when they took the shot. They had nothing a month later, a year later, 2 years later. I think they're in the free and clear.
There's 10 years from now.
There looks like there was almost nothing in these shots. Mm-hmm. So my wife's mother's one of them. Thank the Lord. Yeah. She's in Toronto. We have to get them out. They're older. They're 90 years old. Her husband died. Bless his heart. So she has to take two shots. And so she's been paying attention to this whole thing. She goes, I don't know why you're making such a big deal about these shots. She goes, I took these shots and it's like nothing. I've had flu shots that have more. So she must have gotten a dud. Now, about another two-thirds or just under two-thirds, they get some mild reactions, nothing too serious. The third batch group, which accounts for 4.2% of the doses, boom, Jamie Foxx, Vince Uichu, Cabrera, these guys, they must have gotten batch number three. Now, this is very similar to the CDC V-safe data. CDC V-safe data was 10 million people who got the cell phone act. They took the shots and they were going to report what happens. 7.7% get so sick in the next day or two, they have to go to the ER or be hospitalized. They're probably in that third group, right? That's where all the action is. So I think everybody should pay attention to, did they get sick originally or did they not? Those who got sick originally probably have a bit more of a worry. And there's an interesting paper by Schwab from Germany. It's very, very interesting. People who died of the shot did autopsies. If they had heart inflammation in the heart, there was also inflammation in the arm where they took the shot. And the inflammation in the deltoid muscle looked almost identical to the cardiac muscle. That was a very, very hot paper. So
that's almost the signature if you're going to have a problem.
Signature.
Yeah, like,
it's
fuck,
the signature.
Swollen.
The signature. So, you know, I've had some people in my office that listen, I took the shot within an hour. I could feel the thing crawling up my arm. Women says they can feel it in their breasts. The lymph nodes swell. I mean, it's horrendous. The movement disorders, the blood clots. I've had multiple people get blood clots in their arms. Blood clots in your arms. Since when do you have that? So what we know, to answer Rob's question, is that A, pay attention to what symptoms you had with shot one and shot two. Look it up on mybadbatch.com or how bad is my batch. They're rank ordered, so you can see, were you in the worst batch or you were in the milder batches? That'll give you an idea. And we have a major paper coming out in a few days, September 1st, 2023, and myself and my team in my clinic. And we're proposing what's called base spike detoxification. This is very important. This spike protein from the viral infection and from the vaccine cannot be broken down by human enzymes. It gets stuck in us. Every time you get COVID, you get loaded with this stuff. Every time you take a vaccine, you get loaded and you can't get rid of it. The human body can't digest it. It was engineered in this biosecurity lab. It's an artificial protein. So you can't get rid of it.
It just gets stuck.
It gets stuck.
Wow.
So the Japanese, there we go. They've helped us out again. Tanakawa and colleagues have shown that a natural enzyme, natokinase, dissolves it. Natokinase, N-A-T-T-O-K-I-N-A-S-E. Now, that's in the spike support formula. That's wellness company.
Yeah. Now, I thought you would come out with a different type of supplement.
No.
You know, how fit you are.
This is a spike support. Now, it Great has nattokinase is the principal ingredient. Now, there's some minor ingredients in it.
Dandelion root. Remember I was talking about
when I
was
a kid? Dandelion, I heard all the time. Dandelion tea.
I know you guys like to juice and all this natural stuff. But listen, nattokinase.
5 foot eight. I'll look like a fat midget.
But nattokinase is the natural breakdown product of soy when it ferments with a bacteria called Bacillus subtilis natto. Now, natto's kind of...
Excuse me, Peter. Rob, click on the ingredients. It's interesting.
Yeah, click on that little ingredient panel. I'll show you
what's
in it.
It's really interesting.
But nattokinase is the main part of it. Now, there's some other very good things. Listen, there's a ton of data for black sativa extract, irisimaj, the green tea. But the natto is the big thing. 2,000 FUs, fibrinolytic units. Listen to this. Tanikawa has shown this. Obu has shown this. The spike protein in preclinical models, cell and cell lysate models, the spike protein dissolves. We don't have clinical data. However, the Japanese have been eating natto for 1,000 years for its heart benefits because it's a form of a blood thinner. They've had it as a supplement now for, 20, 30 years where it works for blockages of the arteries in the neck and throughout the body. Japanese have a big belief in nattokinase as a supplement. So in our paper, we're proposing nattokinase become a part of the base. Wellness company, Spike Support. Now, I advise the company as a chief scientific officer. This was the first product out of the gate. We're combining this now with two additional products you can buy elsewhere. One is bromelain. Bromelain is a set of enzymes derived from the stems of pineapples. It also helps dissolve the spike protein by a different method. Mm. Bromelain is an FDA-approved drug. It turns out it's an ointment that's used in burns to help dissolve some protein coagulation in wounds. And so we know that bromelain actually has medicinal properties. So bromelain, 500 milligrams a day. And the third component, again, a natural approach to handling the vaccine. Rob said, what can you do when you start with the vaccine in your body? And that is curcumin. Curcumin's the orange spice. It comes from turmeric. The Indians love curcumin. Yeah. And if you get curcumin, you get it to be absorbed in the body. And there's some methods to do this. Curcumin in randomized trials reduces the spike protein inflammation, makes people feel better, even in randomized trials. So we're proposing a natural approach with nattokinase, bromelain, and curcumin. The reason why we use all three is that it's a difficult problem and we want to speed recovery. With natto alone, I'm telling you, it's a minimum of 3 months, minimum. But once we start to have the others in there, we can speed this. We probably need to continue it for 12 months in most people. But I'm not taking any risks with my patients now. Spike protein is in the heart. It's causing the cardiac arrest. It's in the blood clots. It's causing the blood clots. The government is doing zero research and funding zero research on vaccine injuries. HHS has spent $1 billion in long COVID. They found nothing. And I'm not going to sit on my hands anymore and say, I'm going to wait for the government to tell me what to do. People have blood clots. They're having cardiac arrests. They're having problems now. We're going to kick butt. Base spike detox. The reason why it's the base is you can add other things. People say, what about nattokinase? What about ivermectin? What about? Fine. Add it to the base. But at the base, let's take care of the spike protein. And let's pray that the human body can get rid of this messenger RNA. We still haven't proven that yet. People will take these shots. We're not sure if we can get rid of it.
I just saw last night a commercial for a booster. I swear to God, last night I saw a commercial for a booster.
Well, do you know if someone's following the government guidelines right now?
On Fox.
If you're following the guidelines, you're on your seventh shot.
Is that what they're at?
Do you know how many shots? Do you know anybody who's taken seven shots?
No.
Nobody,
I don't think.
Do you know what? I asked Laura Trump, who's the daughter-in-law of President Trump, on her show. I said, Laura, do you know anybody who's taken seven shots? Hint, hint.
Yeah.
She couldn't think of anybody. So what I propose that your listeners do, your huge mega audience, is they should all visit their doctor, and they can be kind of smart Alex and say, doctor.
Please be a smart Alex.
Yeah. Doctor.
They're all liars.
Are you on your seventh shot, doctor? Your seventh shot?
You're telling me to take one?
Yeah. Are you going to say, you're not? Well, why aren't you, doctor? You should be at seven shots right now. You should be at seven shots. Why? Have you lost your confidence, getting a little queasy about these blood clots or people dropping with cardiac arrest, doctor? You still think I should? I think.
But you like that money when you code that in there, huh?
Well, did you hear about that?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
That Anthem Blue Cross thing?
He didn't take that seven shot, but he's still punching that code in.
This was so bad. Someone got a hold of the COVID shot bonus program. that Blue Cross Blue Shield
real
was
quick
paying?
On your supplement, if one were to take that, because like I told my friend Chris, who runs Podfest, he would have never taken the shot, but he went to UK to deal with Shure, who made like a lot, most podcasters mm-hmm. use these mics, and he wanted them to come to his event that he has once a year. So to go there, he had to get a shot.
Right.
So he spends his entire life's money on it to set up for this event, hoping that it works every year. You know, he's got kids and everything.
Yeah.
So it was early on, so he was like, he knew not to, but he was, you know, it was family money, you know, whatever. Well, guy's 29 years old, boom, out of nowhere, heart clot.
Oh, no.
Was clotted.
Oh, no.
Went, got all kinds, I had texted you, all kinds mm-hmm. of shit, the x-rays, whatever. Right now, it's stabilized. But, like, for him, would he take that every day?
Yes.
Two caps every day?
Two capsules twice a day.
Twice a day. That's what
of this. Two capsules twice a day. This. Add bromelain 500 a day and curcumin 500 twice a day. But two capsules of this twice a day. Listen to this.
We'll have it at the top of the
description. Listen, I had a patient last week, Tommy. He's tall, kind of thin guy. He works in a chicken factory in Arkansas, which is a big chicken coop.
Yeah, that's a whole other story.
A big chicken coop, right?
All the shots are...
And he gets COVID a couple times. It's kind of a close quarters. And then they force the shots on him. So he takes some shots. Now he gets blood clots, you guys. He has blood clots, massive ones in his legs. I mean, whoppers, lower leg, upper leg. They shoot to his lungs. He starts having pulmonary emboli. You can't stop these things. Mm. So they have to put in a filter. They put in a metal filter to try to catch the blood clots as they're shooting up in his body. It's in fear of being treated. So he comes to see me. He's on standard blood thinners. He's loaded with blood clots. I'm like, oh, God, this is not looking good. I put him on this. This is back around November, December, two capsules twice a day, and say, please, God, let this dissolve the blood clots. Now, listen, this is a blood thinner. Remember, natokinase breaks down blood clots. It has natural fibrinolytic effects. So in addition to his blood thinner, so I told him, listen, we have to watch this. It could be bleeding. But so he does it. Sure enough, we repeat his scans just a week or two ago. Clear. Wow. Everything is clear. Said, thank the Lord. He's actually, now we're going to get the filter out. That's so now great. He gets that metal thing out of him.
That's awesome.
And so...
That's got to be the best part about being a doctor.
Yes, yes. Know? And so, you know, because we... Again, I don't have large randomized trials. I'm not going to be able to scientifically say that this does things in human beings. But we're using our best judgment. We're in a crisis now. The vaccine... First of all, the virus created a crisis that we had to respond to. Now the vaccine is creating a crisis. It looks like base spike detox, natokinase, 2,000 units twice a day, bromelain 500 milligrams a day, curcumin 500 milligrams twice a day. The most important message I can give your audience. I'm going to update my website as soon as our paper comes out. Now, I've been very disciplined to not say things that's not supported in the peer-reviewed literature. Unfortunately, this one's over the finish line. We got beautiful figures. It's going to come out in a major journal. I'm going to message it and get it out there. And we can always add other drugs. Now, if people have autoimmunity where the ANA turns positive, we use hydroxychloroquine. If there's protracted infection with COVID, we can use ivermectin or Paxlovid or molnupiravir. We can do other things, but the base spike detox, you can buy it on Amazon. You can buy it on Wellness Company. You can buy it in your natural store. Right now, people are going for it. They're going for it because they know they're in trouble. And by the way, COVID's back. Have you heard of it?
Mm. Yeah, I heard it.
Oh.
Yeah, I heard. I heard yesterday, the day before. It's but real quick, I have to tell you this. So... My friend calls his ex, gets in trouble. He wasn't allowed to call. She had a restraining order. Didn't go there. It was whatever. They hold him for 3 days over here in the county. This whole thing, right? He's in there. Any inmate in Florida, if you get the shot, you get $35 on your books, which means you can buy food, make phone calls.
What?
They give you $35. So now think who that pertains to. People that don't have any money, you know, hey, I'm in here for a month, 2 months. I have no money, nobody on the outside.
They get $35 a day? 30, if they took a shot at any time?
If
you take another shot.
When you go in, he said there's signs everywhere. When you go in, we'll give you $35 on your books if you take the vaccine.
Oh, you're kidding.
And at any time, you could sign up.
Oh, that's a coercion.
And you get 35, and if you don't have money, shit, you're in there for 2 months starving to death.
First time I've heard this.
Yeah, no, honest to God. and this is not a guy who lies. And $35 fucking.
Let's call DeSantis right now. I mean, this is ridiculous.
Yeah, Mr. DeSantis, who every, and that's all Florida. There's not just one here. All. They give you $35.
Crazy.
Never heard of that.
No,
it's an inducement. You know, I heard in Australia, I went to Australia since I've seen you last, and boy, Australia, you know, they were locked down for 2 years. Mm-hmm. When I went to Australia, it was like I was a rock star. I mean, it was like thousands of people came out. I felt like I was like my friend Eric Clapton, except I can't play the guitar. I just kind of know some medical things, you know? And all these girls wanted to take pictures and stuff, and so it was a big deal. But I found out in Australia, they were going, you know, in the interior part of the continent, it's hot as hardly anybody lives there except for the Aborigines.
Yeah.
Like, especially around Alice Springs and stuff. Anyhow, they were offering $1,000 Australian if they take a shot.
Wow.
That's how far they went.
Thousand?
Well, remember these things? Remember you get a raffle. It started out, you get $1 million and a donut.
Yeah, wasn't it like a lotto ticket thing?
Yeah,
like
lotto, $1 million. Yeah. Like pre-college scholarship. It's like, you know,
craziest.
You know, die with a blood clot or win $1 million.
Yeah.
I mean, they state lottery. You, like what like a challenge. I don't know. It's, since when?
I mean, you're having a lotto for a vaccine. I mean, that's some serious shit, Peter. I mean, Dr.
Anyhow, so it looks like we can get people out of it. I'm really worried about these cardiac arrests, particularly with Adamas 2 years later.
Yeah.
We can't predict. I think the safest thing is the ICDs. The subcutaneous ICDs look like it's going to let the players play again, which is nice. By the way, Hamlin for the Bills.
Yeah.
I'm a big Bills fan. Grew up in Buffalo. He's playing.
Yeah.
You think he should be playing this quick?
Well, yeah, I don't. If he's got a subcutaneous ICD, I don't see how they can do hard tackles because that's right against the chest wall. That's a box. I felt Pilot Snow's box. I mean, that's there's just no way. I think he's going without an ICD. Now, when he first got out, do you notice that when he went to one of the Bills playoff games, he was wearing a big bulky sweatshirt? Mm-hmm. And
yeah.
I think he had a life vest on. You know what a life vest is?
Uh-uh.
So when someone's had a cardiac arrest and we're afraid they're going to have a repeat arrest, but we haven't put in a defibrillator, they can actually wear like a fishing jacket. And this fishing jacket, it's like a life preserver. It's right, goes right against the chest. And it'll detect an abnormal heart rhythm and shock. I think he was wearing a life vest at that point. Wow. But I saw him in practice the other day, and I think he's going without a defibrillator. Now, the story he's fronting is that he has commotio cordis. Have you heard of that?
No.
He's saying that he just had a hard tackle and it made him have a cardiac arrest.
Get the hell out of here.
Yeah. So
I did hear that.
Say the way it was struck,
I mean, it's never happened in pro football. The helmet is so big and broad. They wear pads. There's no way this commotio cordis. You know, when he had a cardiac arrest, I got called on Tucker Carlson. The next night, I go on Tucker. I said, listen, I just need to know if he took a vaccine. And because probably the vaccine caused a cardiac arrest. I told Tucker something else. I go, he's going to come off the ventilator. He'll walk out of the hospital. He'll be fine. Everyone dropped their jaw. They go, how do you know? How do you know? I said, because I'm a cardiologist. I do this every day. I mean, they had all these nincompoops on there saying these ridiculous things. He's brain dead. There's all these guys. I mean, I was the only one to tell America what happened and how he was going to do. And that's what I did my job, right? So anyhow, he does walk out of the hospital and he's recovered. I think probably they did all the blood tests. They couldn't find anything. They did the echogram, couldn't find anything, and they did an MRI, and they actually didn't find anything. And now we're stuck. And so sometimes the MRI takes slices of the heart, but it doesn't look at every milligram. There's probably a small patch of inflammation that the MRI missed because of the slicing phenomenon, and he's sitting around as a risk for another cardiac arrest, like Adamas, like Adamas. And we don't know when. And we don't know. Maybe hopefully it'll never happen. But some people have repeat arrest, and that's the reason why the Adamas case is so big. If it happens to one athlete, it can happen to others. There's been a ton of
European soccer players.
Yeah, a ton. So there's a paper I published with Dr. Panagis Polycritis. He's an Italian researcher. We looked at all the leagues in Europe, pro, semi-pro, a lot of soccer and football leagues, like way more than pro football. Age under 35, pro and semi-pro, in a stable period before COVID, the number of cardiac arrests that would ever occur per year would be 29 per year. Since the vaccines, which were mandated on these guys, 283.
Wow.
So it's a tenfold increase.
That's
risk.
A huge.
And they're dropping. Have you seen some of these?
They just drop.
Seen some of these guys drop? Now, have you seen the broadcasters like you? Have you seen the people, the montages of people on TV like the nightly news and they're passing out?
No, I'm yeah. Seen that,
see
no.
if you can pull one of those, Rob. These, so there are a ton of people passing out. You'll find that one on Twitter, Rob. Passing out, and they're newscasters. They're like, I don't feel too good.
Boom. Boom.
And just, yeah, see if you can find it. Rob, this one's great. This is amazing. Now, the point I'm making is, and I actually had to put a statement on my Substack out on this, where I said, listen, this is not all cardiac arrest because, let's see.
It's the soccer guy.
Here's the soccer guy. This
is recovering this morning after a scary incident at the Rose Bowl on Sunday.
He was live on air when Shaka Hislop suffered a medical emergency. I want to warn you, this video may be distressing to watch for some viewers.
Blood pressure is going low. Boom.
Wow.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's not a cardiac arrest. That's actually what's called POTS, posterior orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. So all these guys, and he was up the next day and say, listen, I'm good. It's a form of fainting, and the vaccine causes this. Don't try to Google it. Google's blocking it all. Oh, yeah, you play this one. This
psychologist who fainted during a live TV broadcast is speaking out for the first time about her frightening ordeal.
Yeah, that's POTS.
Go back there again.
No, there's a whole bunch of them. Keep going.
Her frightening ordeal. Yeah. Speaking out for the first time about her frightening ordeal.
Just let it run.
When this happened, I think a lot of people, including myself, thought I was having a heart attack on the air. That was not the case, thankfully.
So what caused Alyssa Carlson to collapse during PayCal TV's Saturday morning news?
You know, we're going to go ahead and go to break right now. Yeah.
Today, Carlson appeared on CBS Mornings to explain what happened.
I hadn't had breakfast that morning. I also had been drinking a lot of coffee, and so most likely I was maybe a little dehydrated. So at that point, I thought, I'm just going to power through. I'll be fine as I usually am.
So what do you think about that?
No, just cut that off, Rob. Try to find the one that is on Twitter.
Okay.
Just go on Twitter search and say, montage of newscasters passing out, because there's a lot of them. There has to be dozens and dozens of them. It's not a low blood sugar, whatever. It's actually what's called POTS, posterior orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. I see this in my office every day.
She says caffeine and didn't eat.
The vaccine changes the balance between sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. The vasoregulatory functions in the body change, and people are prone to passing out. Tons of people have taken the vaccine will say, I feel my heart pounding inappropriately. I feel inappropriately dizzy at the wrong time. I can't exercise. And do it inside Twitter. You will. Maybe you found it. Okay, do this one. But it's usually inside Twitter because the rest of these are all. A compilation of people passing out on TV. Should be able to find it.
This is Treasuries. You all right?
I'm passing out.
Okay, are you okay? You want to hang on?
Passing out.
Okay. You want to sit down?
Gone.
Okay. All right. Whoa. You okay? Okay. Somebody help him, please. Somebody help. We'll be back. We'll be back.
This is amazing how all these are on TV. Niyetiyle
geldiğini asla düşünmüyorum. Yani bunun hem kendisi.
Harage 민감한 o 모습을 나타내면서.
Yeah.
Würde ich jetzt mal machen. Alles okay, wollen Sie gleich ans Expertentelefon gehen, Herr Ohm? Um Gottes Willen.
And this is all over the place.
Let it play.
Istanbul Pendik Milli Eğitim nowhere. Holy hell. Yeah. Let it go, bro.
Let it go. Watch this. Blood flow to the brain.
Yeah, they all get disoriented and
the blood flow to the brain inspired. Goes down.
Okay, I see that. The 70s look right there. I can see that. We've got a little bit of high heel issues, which happens sometimes.
It's not a high heel issue.
No.
They call that syncope. Yeah. I mean, she just takes out the whole display. It's worldwide. This is not an American thing.
It's everywhere.
This is everywhere. Watch her go down. Yeah. You've never seen this before.
Never.
Come on. Yeah, this keeps going and going and going.
Starting today, we have a collegiate challenge. It's open to any college.
I'm afraid.
And you can die just from falling and smashing your head.
Right. So the maxillary fracture.
Let's go back to the studio for just a couple moments.
Ella se está colgando en esta imagen porque ella no, este, no es nada aquí, ¿no? Entonces, yo me dediqué a bailar.
¡Ay! ¡Ay, ay, ay! ¡Oye, qué pasó! ¿De verdad te desmayaste o es un show?
Poštovani gledatelji, u Zadru će ovo biti zasigurno večer za pamćenje.
The crushing burden of unaffordable healthcare.
Gonna pass out?
To free families from the pervasive fear that one illness...
They're trying to hold her up.
There you go, you're okay. I'm right here. I got you. Yeah. No, you're okay. This happens when I talk too long.
Hi, you guys. So I'm here.
I hid that pretty well.
From the Utah Nordic Alliance of Utah, and you guys are teaching me how to cross country ski. So give us some bays.
Oh, okay, you can turn it off. Yep. So before the vaccines, you never saw that. This is just a smidgen, you guys, of what's going on. This is loaded. This is clinical practice right now. I have patients, one after another, passing out like this all the time. It's due to the vaccine. Mm. It's not a cardiac arrest. We rule out myocarditis. It's called POTS, posterior orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. And it is brutal.
Do they come back okay?
They come back okay.
Yeah.
But we have to use some various drugs, some different strategies. We use base-baked detox in them, try to get the spike protein out of them. But people are passing out like crazy now.
I've never seen any of that. Yeah, I think I've seen one. Like they just suppress everything. Every single
thing. But can you imagine? The point is, it's not an American thing. It's not everywhere. Alcohol. Yeah. There are different languages, different regions of the world. What's the commonality is 2/3 of the world's took a shot.
And then they're still pushing it.
Yeah. Still pushing it.
Like everything's okay. And I ask people about it that have gotten like 5. Well, I trust my doctor. I have faith in my doctor. You know how many times I've heard that? Probably 1,000 times.
Do you know, I've written the American College of Cardiology and some other cardiologists in my group. We wrote them. Say, listen, this is fatal now. We have clear autopsy-proven fatal myocarditis. You got Adamus, clinical cases like this. Autopsy-proven. I said, the American College of Cardiology in the fall of 2022 has a statement saying, there's risks and benefits, but the benefits of the vaccines outweigh the risks. I told them, I said, listen, you better revisit that. You better change your guidance. I said, people are dying. I said, this will not turn out good for any cardiologist or any society who continues to back these vaccines. Hmm. And you know what you know what their answer was? Nothing. Completely ghosted me. These are my friends. These are people I know. I've been on these writing committees. They are silent because they know they're wrong.
They're wrong, money, and risk.
And people are dying because of it.
And they don't care. And that's just the truth. Money and the risk. And they don't care if people die. That's just the facts. Like a doctor I know for 50 years, 60 years, I'm only 40. I've known him all my life. He's for the vaccine. I'm cool with it. We used to co-coach soccer. I'd be like, have you not read anything at all? He's like, I recommended blah, 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 blah. Okay. Money. And it's a good guy, but money, risk changes people.
Well, we found out through Anthem Blue Cross Blue Shield. There was a letter. I don't know if you saw it. It got exposed on the internet. But Anthem Blue Cross Blue Shield. Blue Cross Blue Shield is a big commercial insurance mm-hmm. company. Yep. It's not uncommon that a doctor would have like 2,000 patients in their panel of Blue Cross Blue Shield. They were offering a bonus, and still are, I believe, that if they got a certain percentage of their practice vaccinated, and Blue Cross Blue Shield was checking, that they would get a bonus. And if you do the math, you know what that kicker was per the doctor?
I'm afraid
about quarter mil.
Quarter mil. Okay, yeah. Well, there's your answer.
That's your answer.
That's your answer.
So it's about a quarter mil if they push the vaccines. Now, Blue Cross Blue Shield is not giving out $250,000 for nothing. They're getting that money from somebody else. I think all this money is rolling from the U.S. government. Mm-hmm. The HHS and the Biden administration, when they rolled out the COVID Community Core, CORPS funding, it was $13 billion plus. They juiced the systems. Mm-hmm. They pushed these vaccines. Yep. And the money flowed everywhere. Do you know there's still some colleges still pushing the vaccines?
Oh, yeah.
Rutgers.
Some are still mandated.
Yeah. But now we were at probably over 1,000 universities mandating the vaccines at the peak. We're now down to less than 100. But still, they probably haven't met their quota. They haven't met their quota.
To get the fucking money.
I mean, my daughter was working out in L.A., and her employer said, well, you got to take the vax. You got to take the vax. And before we come back to the office, you got to take the vax. So everyone's squirming. My daughter kind of wrote it out. And on the Friday, before they are to return on Monday, they go, oh, we're dropping the mandate. Well, if it was so damn important to come back to the office, why would they drop it the day before they're supposed to come back? Answer, they're trying to hit a quota. I think they took government money or money through an intermediary like Blue Cross Blue Shield or a consulting company or one of these fiscal intermediaries, and it's all about money. It's the only thing that makes sense.
That's the only thing. And why is it that it directly goes to the heart? Why is that? I saw you had written a paper about that.
Because the heart demands myocardial blood flow when you work out, and the vaccine keeps circulating.
That's just the base of it all.
Yeah, and you know, blood flow is pretty static everywhere else, but the heart's demanding. That's the reason why the athletes. You hear preferentially about athletes.
From like, you know, it was just the respiratory, and then now it's heart, you know?
Well, kids too. It is the heart of the matter. People are very worried. You know, we can't do MRIs in everybody, and I think that's the reason why advanced forms of ECGs, maybe blood tests and others. In Invitrogen, a company is going to have a spike protein blood test soon. That's going to be very helpful. We're going to order that like crazy to see who's got a lot of spike and who doesn't. Oh, by the way, I had a patient recently, young guy, really good guy, who his aortic valve was going out. He had a congenital problem. And I examined him in the office. I said, you're in trouble. You need a valve surgery. He goes, you got to be kidding me. I'm 33 years old. Jeez. He goes, I didn't take the vax, and I don't want to get it through a shot in the hospital or a transfusion. I said, well, I can't make any guarantees. You know, you're going to cardiac surgery. You may need a transfusion. So he goes to cardiac surgery. Things go bad, and he gets 7 units of blood. To survive. Yeah. So he sees me back in the office. He's recovering. He's a young father. And I said, listen, you look great. I said, remember, you told me you didn't take the vax. And I said, you want me to check to see if there's any signs that you got the vax through the transfusion? He goes, yeah, you better check. So I can't order the spike protein, but I ordered the extended range assay of the antibodies against the spike protein. And then I ordered antibodies against the nucleocapsid, which is the ball of the virus. When it's just the natural infection alone, the antibodies against the nucleocapsid will be positive, and the antibodies against the spike will be low level, like 300, 400 on this assay, 600, something like that. If someone has never had the infection, which is pretty rare, and just had the vaccine, it'll be just antibodies against the spike. But when we see the vaccine is antibodies against the spike, it's like 20,000, 25,000.
That's the red marker.
It's night and day. So I ordered his, and he had really low level against the spike, low level against nucleocapsid. So I called him. I said, hey, yeah, as far as I can tell, I don't think he got anything.
Yeah, lucky. So you could get it.
You could get it through that.
Yeah. Well, we don't know. It's actually never been documented. I was interested because if he did get it through the vaccine, I would have documented it.
I think the last time you were in, I'm almost positive I asked you about, food. You know, bacon, you know, steak.
Oh, yeah.
If the animals were shot up with the vaccine, is it possible that
they
it could
did it
be
to
passed?
That? They did it in Iowa, too. And all of was it Iowa?
I think
that
Iowa, yeah.
Every chicken plant, I believe in Iowa, got the shot.
Yeah.
Every single one. I believe it was
Iowa. Because you're a big meat eater, right, Rob?
I love meat.
I knew it.
I don't really eat much meat.
Rob's a beefcake. Oh. Yeah, you don't eat much, huh?
Yeah, a little bit.
That's how you keep that skin so... Well, you know, it turns out, you know, I'm reducing my meat. Well, this is what we know, you guys. This is the real deal. The self-replicating RNA vaccines have been in pork since 2017, and I got to tell you, I'm done eating ham. If they have a ham sandwich on the plane, I'm going to turn it down. I'm just not going to eat ham. I just don't like the idea. Now, the cooking and curing of ham should denature the RNA, and it should be okay, but it just spooks me. It's not officially in the beef supply or the chicken supply yet, but the companies want to advance this big time because it's a new market. And do you know some naturopathic? Do you know some naturopathic veterinarians have told me with modern farming techniques, the animals don't need any vaccines. They don't. Mm. It's just, it's an overkill. Do you know we're hyper-vaccinating our pets?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Oh, I know.
Do you know that? You take your dog in, oh, you need another shot.
Yep.
Another shot, another shot. Have you ever seen a squirrel out there taking a vaccine on the front lawn?
No. He's out in the wild.
They do fine. Yeah. They do fine. How about the rabbits? They do fine. There's something about, it's called vaccine ideology, that we have this view that we're vulnerable. Our pets are vulnerable. And that we, mankind, can make ourselves stronger and more resistant by giving these shots. It's almost like a religion, and it keeps going and going and going. And like that doctor you talked about, it may not all be money. It may be that he has a vaccine ideology. It's like a religion. Yeah, it's like vaccines are good for you. Do you know there's one NGO that's out there, a worldwide NGO? There's a lot of them. There's Gavi and Unitaid and CEPI and others. Their aspiration is 500 shots per person. Oh. 500. Just keep juicing on these things. How many shots have you taken in your body? You ever counted up?
Very few.
That's good. How about you?
Very few.
Not a lot.
I hate needles. Maybe when I was a little kid. I mean, I got tattoos, but I hate shots.
You got tattoos?
I have, when I was younger, I was crazy.
We'll talk about that later. You know, I counted up the number of shots I got. I asked my mom. I said, Mom, you know, I've kind of out in the media talking about vaccines. I ought to fess up. You know, what really happened, Mom? And my mom's a good mom. She, a doctor, if the doctor told her to do something, my mom did it. Okay, just the way it was back. You grew up in Buffalo, New York, and you know we respect doctors, right? Right. Mm-hmm. The doctor we went to, I'll never forget when I was a kid, Dr. Severson. And Dr. Severson's office was in his house. Do you remember when the office was in the house?
Yeah.
So his living room was the waiting room. His wife was kind of the nurse.
They would say, just come over when I get home. I'll be back about 8 o'clock.
Yeah. And so it was in his house. Yeah. So we'd go to Dr. Severson's house to get these shots. Anyhow, I got my vaccine card, you guys, and I counted up every shot. You're looking at this body, 69 shots.
Really?
Now, 40 of them are flu shots. Because remember, as a doctor, you got to go to medical school. Yeah, you got to go to the hospital. Yeah. Also, going to medical school, you checked your MMR antibodies. Not good enough. Take some more shots. Turns out I was in the era where the polio vaccine failed. So, take some more polio shots. So, shots. I went to India one time for a medical meeting. Oh, my God, take some more shots. Wow. So, I ended up taking a ton of shots. So, 40 of them are flu shots. 29 of them are other shots. But people have said, Dr. McCullough, you're now an anti-vaxxer. I was like, well, how can I be an anti-vaxxer? I'm a pincushion. I've taken so many shots. I can't be. I'm now vaccine risk aware. I'm just aware of the risks. And I can tell you, seeing what I see right now, we have out there more flu shots. Right down the road here, they're advertising a respiratory syncytial virus shot. There are more shingles shots, pneumococcal vaccine, on and on and on. I can tell you, I've had my fill of shots.
Are there good vaccines? Meaning, I know the one when you step on a rusty nail, what's that called? You have
tetanus,
to go get
tetanus
the tetanus shot. Like, are there actually shots out there that are good and are recommended to get? Because I know a lot of people now, everybody's scared of anything.
Well, you know, there's
rightfully so, but
there's a recent Kaiser Family Foundation poll. I think you have it on one of your tabs, Rob. This is really important. This came out end of June, early part of July. A third of Americans are done with this. A third of Americans basically, scroll down to see the figure. Look at this. 34% of Americans think the COVID vaccines have caused thousands of sudden deaths and otherwise healthy people. Definitely or probably true. Look at the next one. The measles, mumps, and rubella vaccines, also known as MMR, have been proven to cause autism in children, 24%. The COVID vaccines have been proven to cause infertility, 27%. I mean, this is really important. That is a Kaiser Family Foundation, by the way, is a very pro-vaccine group.
Yeah.
So I'm telling you, that's a third of the country knows something is up. A third of the country.
And even with the other vaccines, I had listened to Kennedy, you know, with the whole mercury and all that. And I thought when I was in high school, maybe one person had diabetes. Autism was very rare. Especially the diabetes or like low iron. Never even heard of. Maybe one kid in the entire high school had diabetes. Yeah. Now every 10 people have diabetes or whatever.
But Tommy, the big one is autism.
Autism. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Well, you know, diabetes is on the rise, but you know, autism. I talked to somebody in California the other day. You guys, there's an autism tract.
Yeah.
So now there's a track. So you have, you know, you have like honors and you have science and you have an autism track. There's that many kids with autism.
Do you think that's due to the upping the vaccine when you're a kid?
Yeah, it doesn't look like it's any specific vaccine or aluminum or mercury because they're not consistently in all the shots. And by the way, there's a lot of aluminum allergy shots. It's not the case. It's just the immune system being hyperactivated with all these barrage of vaccines. Mm-hmm. The inflammatory cytokines go up into the brain, probably cause permanent changes, and the vignettes are very graphic. So a child will take 6 vaccines all at once now, develop a fever, have a seizure at home, mother is panicking, and then since that time, the child's never the same again. They have autism. And so that's been proven. So I say, yes, I think hypervaccination is the only explanation for why autism is so incredibly common. We went from a handful of shots when you and I were young to now absolutely getting blitzed.
And all kinds of weird.
Like, it's like having the discussion like we're having. I feel like if we did that more, like maybe it's not from the vaccine, but it tends to show this, right? Like if I take bleach and I dump it on the plant and the plant dies, it probably died from the bleach, but maybe there was something else that did kill that plant. But let's just talk about it and let's look at it. But no one wants to do that right away. It's just, nope, the vaccine is not killing people. They just had heart conditions before. Or, you know, no, the rise of autism is not from the shots. There's a link somewhere. Maybe it isn't the shot. Maybe it's something in the food.
Well,
you could look at
the other experiment. Are there any examples where people take no vaccines and what happens?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a study by Hooker, Miller, Thomas. And then there's an older Amish study. And you know when the kids take no vaccines?
Nothing happens.
They're fine.
Nothing.
Yeah. No asthma or very little asthma, need for tympanostomy tubes, pharyngitis, allergic dermatitis, lower absent rates of neuropsychiatric conditions like ADD, autism, Asperger's, other movement and cognitive disorders. Going natural right now looks so good. And what Kaiser found in their survey is about a third of adults with their kids now going natural. They're saying, forget it. They're not going to skip these shots. Because right now, on the day of birth, the kids get a hepatitis B shot, which has aluminum in it, for sure. And now, starting like right now, they're going to get a depot injection of a monoclonal antibody against RSV. And the first day of life, it's like,
wow.
Let the baby just be natural with the mother. Why do they have to get blasted with these shots?
Well, you know, I grew up in Pennsylvania, so we had what we used to call them half an Amish. Mm-hmm. Because they were Amish, but they had electricity and stuff, you know what I mean? So they were halfway and halfway, but they didn't take any vaccines. Mm-hmm. 5 of them I still, hey, what's up, buddy? Because if I want something built, they make the best stuff, right?
Yes, yes.
So if I need like a desk or something, even though they couldn't make this one because it'd be too heavy. Long story. Anyway, they didn't get any vaccines. No problems. Yeah. Their dad's no problem. Dad's fucking 101 eating bacon. You know, God knows what. He's perfectly fine. You know, piles up.
You know, I lived in Michigan a long time as a doctor, and there was Amish in mid-Michigan. And I tell you what, we used to see them on the road. They'd be in their horse and buggy, and, you know, we'd be driving. And every so often, Amish would bring one of their kids or somebody in the ER. When they brought in somebody in the ER, you better take it seriously because they're going to be sick.
Yeah.
Because the Amish take care of their own medical problems. They figure it out.
Well, you could smell them about 3 miles before they come in.
Yeah, they figure it out.
But they could build shit.
But going natural looks very safe right now because we have a cleaner environment. We have, you know, so many of the illnesses now are legacy illnesses. We don't have overwhelming diphtheria, pertussis, non-typable Haemophilus influenza B. We don't have tetanus, rampant polio, or any of these measles, mumps, rubella, because we have such a cleaner environment. If the vaccines didn't make the illnesses go away, that environmental water quality, air quality, you know, we don't live in squalor anymore. You know, I'm Irish American, and my family came over from Ireland, 1870s, and processed through Ellis Island. We lived in Hell's Kitchen in New York City. Do you know what took out the Irish early on? Mm. Strep. Strep throat. Do you know great grandmother died of Bright's disease, which is, she died at age 32 after 10 kids.
Wow.
With 10 kids. She died of kidney failure due to post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Wow. My grandfather, my dad's dad, died of rheumatic heart disease. Again, strep throat. We don't have strep throat problems anymore. You know why? Because we have antibiotics. So you get a strep throat. We don't have diphtheria and pertussis because we treat it with a Z-Pak. The tetanus shot that you mentioned, Rob, when you come into the ER and you have a nail or something, they give you a tetanus shot. It's not for that nail wound. It's for the next one.
It's for the next
one. So the idea is, could we clean out a wound, give some antibiotics? We don't need a tetanus shot. So you go through the entire schedule. Virtually nothing is compelling.
Right.
Virtually nothing. There's a couple I think are pretty strong. One is rubella, German measles. It's not because you and I have a threat from kids. Boys don't even have a problem with German measles. It's the pregnant women. So if a woman has German measles when she's pregnant, it can be a disaster. The baby can have all kinds of... We used to have about 20,000 cases of congenital rubella syndrome a year. It's kind of like Zika. It's really awful for the... And now with the rubella vaccine, which came in when I was a kid, we're down to like 2 cases a year. I mean, so it's really been a miracle. So I would say as girls approach childbearing years, maybe rubella. Okay, you could make that case. If you're going to go off to a military barracks, what have you, the meningococcal vaccine, something to look at. Me in healthcare, I'm dealing with blood, needles, IV drug abusers and stuff, hepatitis B. We could get it down to a few vaccines that are risk stratified. As opposed to right now, if you just follow the schedule right now, it's a blitz. We're talking well over 100 shots for these kids.
Last 100 time I looked, 113.
It's too much. It's hyper vaccination. We're going to get in trouble. These immune reactions are. There's no doubt. You give a vaccine to provoke the immune system. There's going to be some consequences.
Right. Speaking of aluminum, you know, like the new thing is no aluminum in the deodorant. Is there any truth to that? That if there's aluminum in the deodorant, that's a risk of cancer or carcinogen or anything like that? Or is that just the marketing BS?
Yeah, you know, there's aluminum in various products. There's some in underarm deodorant. There's aluminum in some of the vaccines, by the way. The antigen-based vaccines, hepatitis B, the Tdap, the tetanus, pneumococcal vaccine, the ones that aren't live attenuating, they have aluminum in them. All allergy shots, by the way.
Hmm.
Any kids getting allergy shots are getting aluminum injected.
Wow.
Now, the human body ingests, I think, about 7 to 9 milligrams of aluminum a day. With these shots, I think the first year of life, the kids are getting 4.4 milligrams. We should be below limits of concern. Now, we used to give Alu caps. We used to give oral aluminum for dialysis patients, but we were giving like 600 milligrams, 1,200 milligrams a day, and that caused some aluminum toxicity.
But does the deodorant, is that enough to matter?
Absorbed. I don't think it gets absorbed. I wouldn't get worried. But if you want to...
I know people will clear out their entire closet.
You know, if you really want some really hot deodorant, this is a tip, guys out there. I know you have a lot of guys that listen. Isn't it every man Jack?
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it? Like yeah. It? Every man Jack. Well, listen, my son is a knock 'em out triathlete, and he ran all 4 years for Baylor.
Good for you.
And during medical school at UT Houston, Sean, in his junior senior year, he actually qualified for and competed in the world championships at the half Ironman.
Wow.
And
Sean,
the last time
around,
at the last time he did it last year, he got invited to be on the Everyman Jack team. So he's on the team. It's about 80 of the top riders and
good
runners.
For you, Sean.
And so
you're not messing around, buddy.
So listen, I've got the T-shirt. I'm getting the swag.
I'm getting the deodorant.
Everyman Jack deodorant, I think, doesn't have any aluminum in it. It's a natural, right?
Yeah.
And he got invited to go pro, which is a great honor. But he's been doing an ER residency. And so he can't do pro. So what he's thinking about doing is he's up in Pittsburgh, getting through the residency and then maybe working part-time and going pro. Because you could do that in ER. You could work a few shifts and then and go pro. But he just on Sunday, he competed in a Olympic triathlon just outside Pittsburgh. He won the whole thing.
Oh, congratulations, okay. Sean. Congratulations,
Sean,
buddy.
He won the whole thing. He finished up, showered up, and then went into the hospital, did his rotation. Just like, okay.
You're a monster, Sean. You're a monster, brother. You're a monster.
So,
this podcast is brought to you by Monster Energy.
tear into a can of the meanest energy drink on the planet, Monster Energy. It's the ideal combo of the right ingredients in the right proportion to deliver a big bad buzz that only Monster can. Monster packs a powerful punch, has a smooth, easy drinking flavor. Athletes, musicians, co-eds, road warriors, metalheads, geeks, hipsters, and bikers dig it. You will too. Monster Energy is more than just the green OG. Monster has Monster Ultra, Juice Monster, Monster Hydro, Rehab Monster, Dragon Tea, Monster Max, Muscle Monster, and many more. Buy on Amazon, buy on Walmart, or go to monsterenergy.com and believe me, you'll find a place. Unleash the beast. Monster Energy.
Because I was at CPAC, which is one of the political meetings, and I was at a table where all these I was at a table that was near the VIP table. So I was at this table, and Tulsi Gabbard was there, Ron DeSantis, James O'Keefe from Project Veritas, there at that table. And I was just going to go over and introduce myself because I kind of like her. You know, she's kind of got that deep voice. Have you ever listened to her?
Yeah, I have. Yeah,
she's kind of got a little mojo to her. You know what I mean? So I kind of, you know, she's got some game. So I was going to introduce myself, but then I thought, you know, I would feel like such a gawker. And people were kind of gawking around their table, and I don't like to impose myself. So I figured, well, you know, I'll just let it go. So sure enough, she wanted to meet me, and I didn't know it.
That's awesome.
That's cool.
But I recently went on with Laura Trump.
Yeah.
Laura Trump, yeah.
Speaking of Trump, I wanted to ask, why do you think he hasn't come out? Because he could use that as a play. But he could get hit with then maybe, okay, well, you said that there was no more ivermectin, because if there's ivermectin, then we can't do Operation Warp Speed, because then there would be a medicine that could be possibly used to treat COVID. Mm-hmm. So we have to get rid of that and say it's for horses so that we could do Operation Warp Speed to mandate the vaccine, so on and so forth. Why in the world do you think Trump doesn't come out? These guys, they're not coming out because of money and whatever else. Why doesn't Trump come out?
Yeah, it's hard. I couldn't ask Laura Trump that directly because she's obviously very supportive of her father-in-law.
Sure.
You have to respect family members who really...
And what they're doing to him is absolutely insane.
Yes.
Whether you like him or not.
Whether you like him or not.
That's just wild.
You know, you and I talked about it. We're essentially political independents, right? I think it's
just
good.
For whatever best.
Whatever best for the country. And I think it's important for media to be independent. I wish actually all of the major media... Too. If people would say, listen, we're independent, meaning we're willing to listen to ideas
open-mind.
From everyone.
Yep, be an open mind.
As opposed to a station saying, we are the station of the Democratic Party. We are the station of the Republican Party. It's like, well, like, why do you have to do that? I mean, why can't you listen to all sides? So anyhow, she's...
Even though they all go out to dinner every night together.
Yeah. Right, but so like a family member, I think, is different. So, you know, she... You know, really needs to support her family member. And she's very smart. And so what I told her is I said, listen, this is what she told me. I think our show is coming out in a few weeks. She said, listen, my father-in-law is not a doctor. This is a medical emergency. You know, he sought out and respected the medical advice that he got, but he got really bad medical advice. And what I told her, I said, what we've learned is that you know, former President Trump was lied to. He was lied to.
I think purposely, too.
I know, but when you're lied to and you don't know you're being lied to, what are you going to do? I think that's the analysis. And the question is, what do you do now, though? That's right. So all the presidential candidates are doing something different. The one who's just wide open on this, who made the call, was Robert F. Kennedy.
Yeah.
He said, listen, I called it. These vaccines weren't bad. He's called it on other vaccines. So he's called it. So people understand his view. Vivek Ramaswamy, who I'm told did pretty well last night in the debate.
Yeah.
Young guy, Indian background. He comes out and he's a little hesitant, but he goes, listen, I took two shots, but I regret it. And if I could do it over again, I wouldn't. And then but he navigates him there. DeSantis has come out and said, listen, I'd never mandate these shots, and the kids shouldn't take it. I imagine he probably took it. Most of these guys took the shot. And then the other candidates really haven't spelled out their position. Now, Now, Trump is Trump. What Trump has said, to be fair to him, is he said, listen, I would have never mandated these. And he hasn't wavered from that. The good thing about Trump is when he says something definitive, he doesn't flip-flop.
Yeah.
He
doesn't.
He goes, I would never mandate these. And think about a world where the vaccines were never mandated.
Optional. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If they were never mandated, would we be in this predicament?
No, absolutely not.
No.
Very different.
No. Yeah. And where is Dr. Anthony Fauci yet? He's just disappeared into la-la land. Like, where is Fauci?
Yeah,
just
him disappeared. And Walensky have really... He's got a teaching position at Georgetown.
Oh, boy.
Walensky has just faded. Remember Deborah Birx, the scarf lady? Yeah. Scarf lady's like now CEO of a biotech company. I mean, what? Yeah. I mean, really?
Where are they?
I mean, it's just these guys. In our book, we call it the biopharmaceutical complex. Means it's like a syndicate. It's like you guys know you guys are a mafia family.
Fuck.
The mafia,
when are they coming in, Rob?
The mafia, they take care of each other. It's not the Italian. Listen, 50 years ago, it was the Irish mob. That's us. That's my family.
Yeah.
Then you guys, it was the Italian mafia. Now it's this. It's the biopharmaceutical complex. Yeah. It's a mafia, and they take care of each other. Listen to this. Former FDA commissioner, young, handsome guy, Scott Gottlieb. Who does he work for? The board of Pfizer. They stay in the mafia. So listen, you do a good job in office, we'll get you a nice, sweet board position afterwards. Look at the guy who
follows. We'll make you a maid guy.
Yeah, look at the guy who follows him, Stephen Hahn. He works for the venture capital firm for Moderna.
They made him a captain.
Yeah.
They made him a captain. Who got the concierge?
There's a recent... medical public health leader in the UK. He just gets a job with Moderna.
The links are amazing.
Yeah.
The links are
amazing. So Jeremy Farrar, who's at the Wellcome Trust, he's helping Fauci try to squelch the lab leak thing. This is all came out in the emails.
Yeah.
Farrar gets upgraded from the Wellcome Trust. He's a chief scientist at the WHO now.
Oh, my God.
These guys are all taking care of each other.
It sounds like conflicts of interest.
They're in the complex. Listen, they're in the complex. This biopharmaceutical complex is real. It is a syndicate, and the money is rolling. You know, the Gates Foundation, they're a big part of the complex.
That is sick, man.
They invested a couple million in BioNTech. They got out billions. They're investing in each other, and this money ball continues to roll and get bigger and bigger, and it's so powerful now by the media. By the influence,
the commercial.
Keep the athletes quiet.
Yeah.
Keep everybody quiet.
Everybody
just
quiet.
Keep rolling.
Suppress anything, everything.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck. Now tell me about Disease X, and I don't mean Twitter, which that's a whole thing.
Oh, do you like this Twitter X?
I hate this Twitter thing.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
I keep looking at my phone for Twitter, and I see this black X. I go, that's not Twitter. Oh, yeah, it is.
But why? With Elon, I think he's the arm no one's looking at. 100%. Elon, I do.
What do you mean?
I can't take away all the great things he's done, but I think he's part of it. 100%. I think he's part of the agenda, because unless you could tell me why he would appoint that Linda as CEO of Twitter, and then suddenly 3 days later, Neuralink gets to what? The third stage of the FDA finally? So let me get this straight. He pays double for Twitter, okay? Oh, Elon, he's going to save the world for free speech. Gets Tucker, private messaging, buy a blue check, everybody comes over, Elon. Then he makes, of all people, the most vaxxer lady in the planet.
World Economic Forum operative.
Right. Said professionally, okay. I say vax to death woman, censor to death woman, CEO. Then I tweet a message to somebody, I'm a moron. Calling myself a moron, it gets censored. I can show you the screenshot.
No.
Lose followers depending on who I post on there. I could show you. Appoints her 3 days later, Neuralink is in the final stage of the FDA. Isn't that a little weird? Maybe I'm just a cuckoo.
Now, he's not a conspiracy theorist.
This is kind
he's
of factual,
a rational theorist.
Rational
okay.
thinking.
Rob, you got to pull up this one. Pull up rationaltheorist.com. Rational theorist. So you're a conspiracy theorist, which is the slang. You were just laid out that you're a conspiracy theorist.
Oh, yeah, I'm already a 10.
But your response to that is saying, no, I am a rational theorist. So a rational theorist means you're coming up with a theory, but it's rational, it's debatable, and we can talk about it.
I'd love to be wrong.
Yeah. So it's a rational. So if you, Rob, see if you can bring up rational theorist. This is a brief clip. It's funny because I'm in it.
Are you?
See if you can do it, Rob. I think it's called www.rationaltheorist.com.
This is right. Let's see here. Hold on one second.
It's on my Substack. It's all over the place. So if you,
I hope this is the right website. Let's see. Coming up right now.
That's it. Play this one.
All right. So here we go.
Just play the video.
Yeah. Play it out, Rob, and then blow it up.
Yeah.
Dictate the rules of when and how you can use your money.
Uh-huh. What are you watching?
Well, I didn't know it's some conspiracy theorist spreading the usual rubbish.
But isn't she some kind of investment banker? What if she's right?
Right? Come off the grass, she's a conspiracy theorist.
With COVID-19 vaccines, there isn't a single paper in the New England Journal of Medicine, JAMA, Lancet, where the conclusion is the risks of the vaccines outweigh the benefits.
Do you think that it could be true?
He's a conspiracy theorist.
But isn't he a pretty famous doctor? Like, why would he tarnish his career just to make those things up?
The sharing of biased and
false news has become all too common on social media.
They're all saying the same thing. You see that one
along
where they're all saying
millions
the same thing?
Of others. I have recently been called a conspiracy theorist for the first time in my life. And it just does not sit right with me. We've been forced to embrace this term, but what if it's being intentionally used to discredit people? And then it dawned on me, we've never been conspiracy theorists because our theories are logical, evidence-based, and even debatable if people would debate us. We are not conspiracy theorists at all. We're actually rational theorists. Until now, maybe you've been afraid to ask questions because you've seen people publicly vilified and bullied for doing so. But things have changed. Now is the perfect time to ask questions because you are a rational theorist and your theories are exactly that.
Love it.
Now
love
when somebody
it.
Says
Isn't
conspiracy,
so
I'm going to say, I'm a rational conspiracy.
Yes, and I know her. That's Monica Schmidt from Australia. She's coming over to Dallas next month. She's probably going to stay at my house. And her father's coming with her. She has really been a hero. She's leading one of the freedom groups over in Australia. She spent a little jail time.
It's a great video.
So a little jail time. She's trying to buy milk for her kids, I think. Broke one of the curfews or something.
Oh,
and they,
Christ.
Have you seen some of these pictures in Australia of these cops like brutalizing people?
Yeah.
Have you seen
I see them take out clubs.
Yeah
and just just this choking people. And it's the most ridiculous thing. These brutal images of authoritarian police, and it's been in Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and these cops are wearing flak jackets and they have masks on and stuff, and they're trying to wrestle somebody. And this is in the context of COVID. If you're worried about spreading COVID, the last thing you want to do is get in a wrestling match with them, right?
Right.
And especially, I mean, can you imagine? You pull down the mask.
Game over, right? Doesn't take a doctor of 20 years to realize
the
that.
Most ridiculous thing is, have you seen these newsreels in China where they're wearing hazmat suits and they're tackling each other and trying to stuff swabs up each other's noses? I had a chance to interview Eugenia Barrientos, and she's from El Salvador in Central America. Tiny little woman. She's fearless. And she's treated tens of thousands of patients. And she figured out how to treat patients without hydroxychloroquine and without ivermectin. So she uses a different combination of drugs. Great lady. And I asked her, I said, have you ever worn a mask? She goes, no. I don't wear a mask. She goes, I'm not going to. And she's just people coughing in her face and whatever. She's, yeah, I'm fine. and she's treated all these patients. And I said, what do you think about the Chinese wearing hazmats? If you've come
with shields,
yeah. If you've come face to face with tens of thousands of COVID patients and you're perfectly fine, what do you think about people wearing these hazmat suits? She goes, they've lost their mind.
They need to be in the loony bin.
They're in the loony bin. Think about this. I mean, you think about the ridiculousness. Is that, for instance, let's say you have your grandmother. And she's at home and she has COVID and you're trying to take care of her and you've been around her. She's coughing and hacking. You're giving medicines. And you finally get to the point where it's time for grandma to go in the hospital. Grandma goes in the hospital. Suddenly you can't see her.
Yeah.
No, there's isolation. Wait a minute. I was just with her for the last 2 weeks. If I have it. This business of not letting family members see each other and they died alone in the hospital, that's reprehensible. Any person with common sense would know, come on, if you were just there for 2 weeks, what's the big deal for you going in the hospital?
Get over it. Let's go.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so wrong.
Now tell me about disease X.
Oh, yeah. Disease X.
Is this going to be a whole other thing?
Well, listen, part of this syndicate, this biopharmaceutical complex, if you go back to 2012, it's the U.S. government, it's the military, the research groups, the National Institutes of Health. They are really into developing biological threats like a virus or another organism that could cause disease. You could actually use it as a threat and then an answer, a vaccine, monoclonal antibodies, therapeutics. That's the new normal. Instead of missiles and shields, we now have biological threats and what they call biological countermeasures. Well, one of the big players in this is Peter Daszak. Peter Daszak leads the EcoHealth Alliance. He's kind of a megalomaniac. The EcoHealth Alliance is an NGO. They work closely with the NIH. They're well-funded. He got paid $250,000 of U.S. dollars to fly back and forth first class for years to Wuhan, China, shuttling the plans from Ralph Barrick at University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill to Wuhan. They're the ones who cooked up SARS-CoV-2. It's Peter Daszak. Well, Peter Daszak wrote a New York Times piece in 2020 saying disease X in 2020. And it was February of 2020. And Peter Daszak says, disease X, it's here. It's here. This is COVID. It's disease X. We should do disease X research. We should actually theoretically try to come up with more diseases and then come up with more answers so we're ready. The problem with Peter Daszak is, yeah, look at that. Click on that. Peter. Don't click on the video. It's too long. That's Frank Gaffney, is a great guy. But scroll down. Gaffney snuffed this out. Keep scrolling down. There's a picture of Peter Daszak. But there's even, there it is. That's Peter Daszak.
February 27th, 2020.
These guys want to cook up viruses that can be new diseases for which they can make vaccines. It was announced in the UK. They have a Disease X laboratory, probably deep down in some dungeon below London or something, where they're trying to cook up another monster. Turns out there's biolabs all over. Biolabs in Ukraine. There was one in Sudan. Did you hear about the Chinese biolab in California?
No.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. So anyhow, it turns out that somebody was stumbling upon some warehouse. Things looked like it was kind of fishy. And it was a Chinese biolab in California. The Chinese were keeping it secret. They were staffing it. They had all kinds of bugs in there, all kinds of nasty things.
Shit.
It wasn't under the regulatory authority of anybody. See, they weren't registering it with the FDA or the NIH. They were just working on something bad.
Now, the thing that I heard about a week ago or a couple of days ago that there's something going around now, is this what they're referring to? Is that other thing?
No, what's going around now is called, it's an Omicron variant. It's EG5 and FL. So it's EG and FL. They're new variants. We are in another outbreak, you guys. You're going to get it again.
Right.
You're going to get it.
I don't know if I ever got it.
You're going to get it. We're all going to get it.
I don't know.
My mom just got it. When I'm done with this podcast, I'm going to call mom. She's in the senior center. She's got it.
I'm sorry to hear that.
You know, she's fine. She's on McCullough Protocol. Go to my website, Rob. You got it up there. McCullough
Protocol. It's tab 3. Yep.
What we need to do, just scroll down and just click
You'll
on
see
it
the
and expand
protocol.
It. McCullough Protocol has saved millions of lives. You know, Peter Hotez got nominated for the Nobel Prize. He didn't save anybody.
Yeah, click on that there to
my
expand.
My protocol has saved millions of lives.
Yes, it has.
So mom just worked the upfront part of the protocol. She's self-quarantined in her apartment for 5 days. She's using the povidone iodine nasal sprays and gargles. She's doing it 6 times a day. I told her, open up the windows, get some air flowing in there. And she's working the over-the-counter bundle, the next dark blue box. So put your pointer up there.
Zinc.
Zinc, yeah. 50 milligrams. Vitamin D, 20,000 units. Vitamin C, 3,000 milligrams. That vitamin C, by the way, is 3,000. She's taking it several times a day. Quercetin, 500 milligrams twice a day. Famotidine, 80 milligrams, which is over-the-counter Pepcid. It's 4 times a daily dose. And aspirin. So mom is jamming on this.
Pepcid, that always made me laugh when Pepcid was one.
No, because it actually works against the virus.
I know, it was just funny to me.
So mom is nearly through it. I was a little bit worried because, you know, she's elderly and she's frail. And she had COVID last year. She had the full McCullough Protocol last year. She got ivermectin. And the first illness, we need to run the drugs. So mom got the first protocol last year, and she got through it within about 5 days. So my wife shuttled it over. She did great. This is her second illness. So I said, Mom, I don't think you need the prescription drugs, just the over-the-counter. But I sent a doctor over yesterday to listen to her lungs. Clear. And I talked to Mom on the way to the airport last night when we were coming to see you. And she's doing great. I'll check on her again. Listen, when someone gets COVID, you guys, and you have an elderly parent, a grandparent, communication. Call frequently and check on them. To make sure they don't miss a dose or something, they don't get confused. Keep reminding them. The nasal sprays and gargles are super important. I got it right in my bag now. I got iodine. Now, I flew here last night. Before I got on the plane, I did a couple squirts of the iodine spray, and I went to the bathroom, and I have a little throat spray. I sprayed it, and I actually gargled a little bit in my back of my mouth. Got on the plane. Got off the plane. Hotel, did the same procedure. This morning, woke up. This stuff is traveling on the plane. My mom and my brother got it on the plane because they took an Alaskan cruise. They're flying back from Seattle. That's where mom got it. I guarantee the iodine nasal sprays and gargles, they work. Masks do not work. Mm-hmm. Masks probably make it worse because you're breathing it back in and it's just you're not getting good airflow. The iodine works.
My doctor, before I met you, who got indicted, another one with all this shit, he was one. He was like you. He actually read, before I met you, he read all your stuff.
Yeah.
Remember, come in and I said, hey, you got to start using this.
Like, what the fuck is he doing over here?
He got indicted, all kinds of stuff.
I think
it stemmed from a lot of this now that it came out. He got out. They actually indicted him, sentenced him. He appealed it with all tons and tons of lawyers. Out, case is over, dropped it. In the feds, that never happens in the feds. But he had,
I tell you,
killer lawyers.
Yeah, these lawyers are eating us up, though. I tell you right now, I can't find help to really.
Yeah.
Now I did start McCullough Foundation. Maybe bring that up.
I did get lawyers
to do that. Very important. McCullough Foundation is supporting all this work, you guys. Now this is 501c3. It means it's tax deductible. You can donate right on the website. We are working in the area of. Clinical investigation and scholarship, McCullough Protocol, base bite detox, whatever's coming up next. Media and communications, very, very busy. You know, I'm a frequent contributor on Fox and all the other major stations and need support there. Legal, I am a expert witness in over 100 cases right now, helping the military, helping people been screwed by these vaccines. Yeah. So I need the financial support there.
And every little bit helps. Yeah. And you can write it off. 501c means you can write it off.
When you click on it, and you go through the checkout, you actually get a statement that says, this is for your taxes.
To your accountant.
Give to your accountant. So this is that we really set up the website well. And
we'll have that up top.
And then the fourth area is advising lawmakers. So I flew to New Hampshire on the foundation last weekend, and I was asked to advise about a dozen members of Congress there, of their House, about how they should set up their investigations, lessons learned. The reason why everybody's going through this now, lessons learned, because the next pandemic coming, we've been told there's going to be something, you know, Marburg or paramyxoviruses, what have you. We've got to be ready. We have to learn from what didn't work so we can respond better. I think next month is going to be so interesting because you probably heard Alex Jones, where he broke the news where a TSA whistleblower or TSA informant, I shouldn't say whistleblower, informant, told Alex they had a meeting. They're going to lock down starting September 15th. We're talking full masks and everything in the airports.
Look,
yeah, you guys.
Jones is, in my opinion, he's been pretty on about 85%. Maybe the date's a little bit off, but he's, in my opinion, he's 85% on the mark. Maybe a little bit later, maybe a little
have
bit.
Have you ever had him on your show?
No, I haven't. I haven't. I've had Roger Stone on a bunch of times.
Have you?
But
you have
not
Alex
now.
On. I'm pretty close to Alex, and when I first went on with him, I was a little bit worried. Now, again, I'm a political independent. Meaning, independent means I'm not afraid to vote for a Democrat. I'm not afraid to vote for a Republican. I've always been, you know, fair to everybody. And I don't have any tattoos. I don't smoke. I've never shot a gun. I'm just not a hardcore right winger. And I've always thought Alex Jones is like the hardcore right winger. And my wife says, "Oh, don't go down and go on with him. He's just too crazy, you know." So I went down there and I told Alex, I showed up like this. I'm a doctor. I said, "Listen, I'm just a doctor. I just want a straight interview, a clean interview." And his producer said, "Alex, no tricks, no stunts, whatever." Because Alex has done stuff like get a bunch of ivermectin and gobble it right on TV and stuff. He goes, "See, I'm fine." Anyways, he's a little bit of a, he's got that bullfrog voice. You know, he goes, "Get your guns, get your ammo, they're coming for you right now." You can imagine people, you know, out in rural Alabama somewhere saying, "Martha, get the shotgun."
Go Jones.
So anyhow, I got down there, I had a chance to meet him, and he is the best guy. He clearly understands everything. He's so well-read. He gets up early in the morning. All those stacks of papers in front of him, he's read every page. He knows the facts. Alex is so fair. He's a very fair person. He's respectful. And I will engage with him in an interview like this, and he'll say, "Doc, just slow down, start over, and explain it." You know, he wants to get it to an understandable level,
simple
terms, which is actually so important. He's smart enough to realize the need that everyone's audiences have different ranges, right? And there's several times where Alex said, "Listen, I'm going to walk out of the studio. You tell America what you want to tell America." I mean, what an interesting guy. So
yeah.
I think what Rogan said about Alex, and you know, Alex's studio is not that far from Rogan's studio. What Rogan said about Alex is that Alex Jones is the most misunderstood man in the world. And he is. He's incredibly misunderstood.
I wonder if Spotify went to him about Alex, too, because he hasn't had Alex back on. That's weird. Mm-hmm. It's just weird to me because they were so...
Alex said is that, listen, that the Biden... It's also all over the internet. The Biden administration is messaging. They're going full lockdown. They're going to try to go full lockdown. And they're going to try to time this with the new vaccines. Now, the new vaccines will be XBB 1.5. XBB 1.5 is already faded out. The vaccine is already too late. It's less than 5% of cases. It's going to be down to, by the time the first shot comes out, there won't be any more of that strain around. So they're hopelessly behind. Right now, they're giving BA4, BA5. That's gone.
Do you think there's any shot that this is so that Biden doesn't have to physically debate, like in person?
Again,
Well, that's a good point. Is it time for presidential politics? Remember, Biden
he's
won
gonna
last
have a tough time.
Time
on a
remember,
stage.
He won last time from his bunker.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Remember, he was in
basement.
His bunker,
and he's been in his bunker since. From those well, parts,
is he going to debate Kennedy? I don't think he is.
He ain't doing that.
You know, have you been following Robert F. Kennedy and his?
Yeah. We're still going.
Yeah,
we've been following.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm following him too. I know him personally.
Oh, I like him a lot.
I bet you know. The thing is, people say, "Well, Dr. McCullough, are you going to get behind Kennedy or get behind Trump or DeSantis?" I said, "Listen, I'm an independent. I do more media, by the way, than all these guys."
Yeah. Oh, I know.
Way more. I said, "So, I think all the presidential candidates need help. I'm happy to help all of them. They all need help." Then people say, "Well, how can you help Kennedy?" I said, right now, Kennedy is in the weeds. He's trying to litigate everything.
They're suppressing him to death.
Well, he's trying to litigate vaccine details, and he needs to get out of the weeds and say, "Listen, I'll have McCullough or Lyons-Weiler or someone else litigate vaccines for me." You know, he needs to get on the big picture of foreign policy, domestic policy, the economy, education, immigration policy, and get out of the weeds. He's in the weeds, and he's a lawyer, so he's like, "Oh, I want to litigate something." It's like, no, you're trying to be president.
We had him coming in, and then he went on Rogan. Like, we were going back and forth with the date. Then he went on Rogan, and then their dates got jammed up. So
we'll probably get him back. He's doing, by the way, out of all the people in the media, Kennedy's doing the best in the media.
I like him a lot.
You chirp Instagram or Twitter. Yeah. He's up. He's more than anybody. So that's Kennedy. Biden isn't doing anything.
Nothing.
Campaign-wise. And clearly has no new ideas. So that would be on the Democratic side. You got RFK and you've got Biden. On the Republican side, you've got one of these 15 people, and none of them can get any airtime. I mean, you got Larry Elder, you got Tim Scott,
13,000 people,
Mike Pence. They can't. I get more. Yeah, I actually have a bigger Instagram presence than they do. I mean, because I get the feeds. How come they're not coming up? The thing that there's nothing stopping them from giving a few comments on Instagram and getting out there. None of them. I kind of wonder, who is their social media managers? Who are their
media
managers?
Or they just run raise money.
Well,
because some of these guys, you know that they have, they know they got no shot.
Well, here's the thing. Why would one be one of 15 people running on the Republican ticket if you didn't want to be president? Well, one reason would be that you really just want a place in the cabinet.
True.
So if you were running on the Republican ticket and you just wanted a place in the cabinet, you would never attack Trump.
Right.
Because Trump's got majority.
Landslide, right?
And you would be deferential to Trump, supportive of Trump, and just try to stay alive and be a cabinet pick. Most of them look to me like they're trying to be cabinet members.
Yeah.
Because they're not attacking Trump. Anybody who attacks Trump directly, they're going to be out, right? He's going to say, listen, you attack me too much, you're not going to be in the cabinet.
You're done.
So Christie is, you know, he's done. And all of them are going to try to figure this out. But in the end, the ones who sincerely want a shot in the Republican primary, they're going to have to take on Trump. Now, Trump, so all of them, A, they need better managers. They're getting no social media time. They're getting no interviews. I get more interviews than they do. They're getting no interviews. And none of them have sufficiently distinguished themselves with any new ideas. I mean, the whole purpose to get a new person is to get a new idea. Mm-hmm. We're not really hearing much in the way of new ideas from any one of them. DeSantis, and I've had a chance to go to one of his events personally, had a chance to meet him, spoken on stage just ahead of him once or twice. DeSantis clearly has got the resume, right? So he goes to Harvard undergrad, mm-hmm. he goes to Yale Law School, he becomes a Navy SEAL, then a Navy officer. He's a three-term congressman, wins just by a smidge on that first election against that guy who turned out to be a real mess, right? That guy, what's his name?
The African-American guy.
He's caught in some type of drug bust or something. He's done. And then he does so well as a governor. In his second term, he wins by a landslide. So talk about the resume. The resume, and when he got up on stage, when I listened to him, clearly powerful message. He was hitting all the points. DeSantis's wife is very impressive. She's won an Emmy Award as a journalist, three kids, and he's clearly got it. So I think DeSantis, to me, would say, boy, he's got the resume. But where's the airtime? Where's the press releases? Where's nothing?
He can't beat Trump.
He's just absolutely been silenced. And again, not knowing how to deal with Trump. So you have the 15 that are all in that group who they appear to be, outside of Christie, they appear to be actually really just running for cabinet positions and not going to take on Trump. Now you got Trump. The left media, the liberal media, loves Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And the right media loves Trump. We got a problem. If the left and the right love Trump, he's going to get all the airtime.
Yep.
And he's got it, right? Now, the left love Trump because he sells advertising.
Right.
So, it's another indictment. It's another
commercials.
His name is coming up on the liberal media constantly.
True.
His name is coming up on the conservative media constantly. So the left,
independent, constantly.
So the left media would say, there's another disturbing arraignment of former President Trump.
Disgraced.
Disgraced. serious charges. He could be, and we're outside the courtroom. Let's get our correspondent, you know. And Trump could be, so, and then on the other side, this, the right side would say, this is attack on civil liberties. They've weaponized the DOJ, this and that. So they're both, on Trump. So he's got all the airtime.
And they almost went so far with it. If they would have just came down with one good one, you know, it would be more of a punch to him. But for even the people on the left are like, come on, this is a little messed up.
I'm an independent, so yeah. I'm not, I'm not bleeding for Trump right now. But I'd have to say, listen, if these crimes, these alleged crimes, were so heinous, where was this in year? What was this in the year after he gets out of office? Yeah. Why don't we hear about this? Why is it coming to election year? Number two, when you actually look at the allegations, none of these rise to the level of something that isn't within. Let's take this declassified documents and stuff. Yeah. Listen. I've testified in the U.S. Senate. I have submitted an official U.S. Senate biosketch, a U.S. Senate prepared remarks. U.S. Senate, I've been in Washington. I know what it's like. I can tell you, the number of handouts, the number of paper floating around there, probably everybody could be busted for having a handout somewhere in your garage or what have you. It's not, this document management isn't what people think.
It's nuts.
And you know, if they found, you know, the plans to a Russian nuclear factory or something different. But if they found a handout from McCullough's speech or something, come on. You know what I mean? Give me a break. So not finding some terrible thing and also not finding malicious intent or anything else.
Throwing shit at the wall.
I just think they're... So what, the most interesting thing is by doing this, they're keeping him in the media constantly, which is selling ratings. He is clearly being victimized, and he's going to be almost now being held up as a martyr. And even people in the middle like me, we're gravitating towards Trump.
Yeah.
Because when he, you know, when the poor guy comes up for air and he does, he's able to give his opinions on what's going on, it sounds pretty good. I listened to a speech he gave on homelessness the other day, and it was really solid. He was hitting the points. He's clearly brought up this biopharmaceutical complex and this globalist agenda. He has got that down. He's been beaten up a lot. You know, I know Steve Bannon pretty well, and I have a lot of respect for Steve Bannon. Again, as a middle guy, and people think Bannon is a right-winger. Bannon's got it all in his head. He's got it all. He understands all of this, and he understands partisan politics. And Bannon believes the best thing for the country is Trump to come back. Trump deserved this second term. He's still strong enough. He's still young enough to do it. And that's what America needs. And most, I think most people in that Republican National Committee believe that's what should happen. The problem is the Republican National Committee is not the general voting American.
Right.
Now, you ask the general voting America. I ask my mom. My mom's in independent living, getting over COVID right now. My mom is a lifelong Republican voter. She's going to pull the R, okay? But I asked my mom, I said, well, what do you think about all this presidential politics and all these campaigns and stuff? She goes, you know, I don't want to see another Biden-Trump matchup. She goes, I just want to see something new. Mm-hmm. And John Leake's mother said the same thing.
Yeah.
I just want to see something new. So the average person doesn't like a rematch. Now, when you watch the Super Bowl and you see two teams battle it out, and then there's finally a winner. A month or two later, you don't say, wow, I really want the same Super Bowl next year. You never do.
Well, he does.
Well, my team lost, so I want them to go back.
No, if you're...
But yes.
Rob, if you're... Forget your team. Let's just say it's a Super Bowl. Yeah. You don't dream about a rematch. No one does.
Boring.
No one dreams about a rematch. Everybody says, give somebody else a chance.
Yeah.
So the natural inclination is to give somebody a chance. So the problem is... It looks like we're dead set at a rematch, of which people are not going to be that enthusiastic.
I think Michelle Obama is going to announce that she's running in November.
Mm.
And that's not me. That's from Joel Gilbert, who must have stalked her for 4 years.
So everyone's going to make predictions. Well, you know, I can tell you as a medical doctor, I was asked to go on Fox News recently. I wasn't on, you know, for months. I thought maybe because I didn't sign off on the woke restroom policy. I'm a frequent contributor on Fox News. But no, the restroom policy didn't come up to me. But you probably heard about it.
Yeah, I did. I thought it was fake.
Yeah, if a transgender goes in a woman's, if a man who is fantasizing to be a woman goes in a woman's restroom, the woman has to get out.
No,
oh my God.
And go to the neutral bathroom. Fuck. Yeah, that's the policy. No, it's just, it's Fox. That's Fox. So anyhow, what I think we're going to have is we're going to have this rematch. The American public is not going to be juiced up for it. If it's Biden versus Trump, there's not enough juice in it. That means voter turnout's not going to be that great. And voter turnout's not going to be that great. You know what happens? The elections are a cheating match.
Oh, yep. Who's going to rig it more?
And remember, the only time there's really a win is when there's a landslide. You have to win overwhelmingly. Whoever loses claims the elections were rigged. So remember, Hillary Clinton loses, it's election integrity, and the elections are rigged. Trump loses, the elections are rigged. So remember, election integrity is always about who loses.
Right.
It's a loser. It's kind of a sour grapes thing. So it's a cheating game. It's always been a cheating game. If you read David McCullough's version of Harry Truman, back in his day, the Irish mob cheated, controlled, rigged the elections all over the country. The Irish controlled this country. And bottom line is, we've never had fair elections.
No.
Because we can't get to electronic elections that are solid. It's all this paper. Remember Al Gore? Remember hanging chads?
Yeah.
That's because people don't want fair elections.
Yeah.
So I got a chance to speak at True the Vote. Have you heard of True the Vote?
I have. Yeah. I have.
What's the guy's name? Greg? Greg Phillips? Is it Greg with the beard? And
I believe
that woman?
So, yeah.
They were in jail for a while.
Yeah.
So anyhow, they said, Dr. McCullough, can you speak at True the Vote? I said, well, okay. And so, I land in Phoenix. I thought they were going to put like a black hood over my head. They would say, we're taking you to an undisclosed location. I was like, whoa. I was like, I am not a hardcore Republican, and I don't have a gun. So, anyhow, they take us out to this giant metal barn out in Phoenix, Arizona in August, and it's blazing hot, and like all these hardcore election integrity guys there. And they're all have their six shooters out and guns. These guys, there's probably more guns and ammo in the place than you can imagine. And there was the media was there, you know. And here I am. I show up. I'm just a doctor. And Carrie Lake came out. I took a nice picture with her, by the way. She's so pretty.
Yeah.
She's got the most attractive features. And a lot of guys say about Carrie Lake, they don't like short hair in a woman, but on her,
It fits.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Anyway, I took a picture with her. So I got up on stage, and I have all these hardcore guys. I said, listen, I'm just a doctor. But I said, you know, I've never felt like we've had fair and informed elections. As a voter, I said, here are my requirements. Here's my requirements. I go, you guys haven't done anything and will not do anything until you meet my requirements. Here are my requirements. I show up in the voting booth. When I see a name, I need to be able to see a standard government bio sketch. I want to know who they are, where they went to school, what their education is, and I can hover over it. You can provide it in paper. I don't care. But never ask me to vote for a name ever again, a name with no information. That is BS.
Mm-hmm.
That is a bunch of crap. When you vote for a condominium association, you know more about your candidate.
Yeah.
This idea that we just list a bunch of names. Like here, pick the name.
Yeah.
That
this
is
this name looks
crap.
Cool. Pick
yeah,
it, right?
Yeah, it's a name. It could
I
be
like
a,
that name.
Could, yeah. So we're voting for names with no information. And people say, well, you're supposed to bring a scorecard. I said, I'm busy. I'm coming from work. I don't have to. I said, I want to walk in a standard. If I have to provide a standard government biosketch to testify in the Senate, candidates sure as hell can do a standard government biosketch. And it can be short, but I want to know, do they have a college education, where they grew up, what are their values? Who are they?
Yeah.
So we vote for unknown people. I said, that's the first thing. So standard government biosketch. I said, then I want to vote. I don't care how you do it. They go, well, we need to have paper ballots. I go, knock yourself out if you want paper. You want electronic? Fine. Whatever you want's fine. I said, I want to vote. Then I need to go home. Then I need to log in, and I need to see who I voted for. I've got to see that my vote was registered, and I need to see who I voted for.
Yeah.
Then, after the elections are done, I need to be able to log in again. I need to see if I picked winners or losers. I said, until we have that, we don't have voting in this country. These people, all juiced up, and they're all pumped up with testosterone, and their guns and their ammo are all fired up about election integrity. They don't give a shit about election integrity. You know what they care about? They only care about winning.
Yep.
And, you know, and none of these guys would be at True to the Vote. If Trump would have won, they wouldn't have cared. There would be no True to the Vote.
They should go to the Irish bookies and the Italian bookies.
There you go.
And have and they, go to they, them they, and say, how do you calculate who took what bet and who won what and who lost?
Listen,
and they'd have the perfect organization ever for the voting.
Right. You got to beat the Irish mob. You got to beat the Italian mob. If these
just go
guys,
talk to them and say, listen, how do you do your bookmaking?
Unless we have what I describe, we'll never have fair elections. And if it's a cheating game, then don't complain about it. Right?
If you're not going to do anything about it.
Trump's like, oh, I lost the election. They cheated. Well, listen, you said ahead of time, if you lose, it's because they cheated. You called it. And you're a big cheater, and you got out-cheated in a cheating game. So quit complaining about it. Just like it or lump it. I'm sorry. You can't be sour grapes for all this time. You got to be big and bad and strong in this country.
Got to move on.
And if he's not big enough and strong enough and not tough enough, then quit crying about it.
Yeah, he's got to move on because he's got good policies. Just stick to the damn policies.
You know, this business of, well, I lost. Well, you lost at a cheating game. Yeah. It is a cheating game. You got to win. If the Republicans are not as good at cheaters as the Democrats, then they have to
up your game.
Yeah. Get stronger and win by a landslide. The problem is getting this rematch is not setting us up for a landslide. No. Remember the polls. The polls that show Trump is so far ahead, it's among likely Republican voters. That's very important.
Yeah.
So among likely Republican voters, which is a smaller group, Trump's got the lead. Now you look at the whole country. What you're really interested in is in the country.
The country,
and
right.
He's not carrying the whole country now. So that's the problem. So people aren't interested in a rematch, and B is not carrying the country. And so it really, putting Trump up there really bothers me, because if he wasn't strong enough to win last time, you know, the Trump supporters are not any stronger and they're not any numerous. I mean, maybe they'll get some more people in the middle who say, listen, Biden did such a bad job, I got to jump over to the Republicans. But, you know, something's got to change, right? I mean, we're kind of at a stalemate.
We're at a stalemate. But, you know, I don't know what you do with that disaster. But the transgender epidemic.
Oh, yeah.
I read a lot of your, I definitely wanted to get to that.
Yeah.
When did you, you know, I had heard, you know, trans people, gay people, blah, blah, blah. But this whole surgery thing, it's like I woke up one day and I see that people are getting surgeries and then kids are getting surgeries. And then, you know, a five-year-old was talking about surgery, this craziness. And to me, when you take it that far, it's almost like people that are gay, they wanted the right to get married forever. So you give it to them. Then they wanted the right to do A, B, C, D, or the trans wanted to be accepted. Okay. Then you come in with this whole other thing, this surgery thing that kind of is like an F you to the gay community and everything else. Like, okay, let's just cut you apart and do all this. When did you notice this insanity of this?
It turns out the Europeans were ahead on this. It's been
the
going
Europeans
on.
The Europeans were?
Yeah. It was going on for about 15 years. They almost went through a phase.
Really?
You know, recently the UK, the Netherlands, Sweden, they've actually all phased this out. They went through it a phase and they phased it out. What we've learned is there has always been a small group of men and women who, you know, prefer the same gender, homosexuality. And this has been gone on for centuries, if not the millennia, through Roman civilization, remember, in the time of Caesar.
And excuse me, I just want to ask something right in the middle there. If a male or female has a feeling that way, mentally, they feel A, B, or C, don't you think maybe they should go to a very good therapist or something like that first and discuss their feelings with them first before you jump to I'm gay or I'm...
Let's take the scenario where someone grows up and they have a normal childhood, they go through a normal puberty, and now they're a full-blown adult, And they, over time, decide a man likes a man more, a woman. Cool. You know, that can happen. It doesn't necessarily reflect psychiatric disease or psychological disease. It's been going on since the millennia. You know, as a doctor, we're very inclusive. You know, this DEI, diversity, ethnicity, inclusion. I can tell you, I've taken care of homosexuals, bisexuals, drug abusers, prisoners, fat people, skinny people. You know, criminals. I mean, you name
everybody's
it.
Everybody's a human being, one way or another.
The bottom line is, as a doctor, I mean, I'm as diverse as you can be. So there's absolutely zero prejudice in our field.
Yeah.
And by the way, doctors are not dominated by white men, if you've noticed.
Yeah.
My son just graduated from medical school, you guys. 9% white men in his class. So the doctors are the most gender and race diverse group ever. So you can't look at us and say, you're a white guy, McCullough. You got your white privilege. That's a bunch of
bull. That's a bunch of bull.
So the bottom line is, homosexuality, bisexuality is part of society, and those are people's choices, and they should have every right as everybody else. It's just a choice. It's just a preference. You may like blonde girls or brunette girls, and people have their choices.
I meant referring to this when you're 10 years old, 12 years old.
So that's the difference.
When you're 21A, whatever you want to do, you do.
That's not me to tell you
what to do.
Right. I was trying to establish.
If you respect me, I respect you. I don't care what you know. I share on life.
So this LGBT. I'm going to stop
QA,
there.
QACL. No,
I'm going to stop. LGBT.
Plus, minus.
So, negative. LG. So, lesbian, gay, bisexual,
transgender.
And transgender. Yeah. We'll say LGBT. Okay, so we'll stop there. So, that's all fine as an adult. Let's take adults first. This is easier. Let's take adults first to say, listen, how about someone as an adult who's already, a fully developed man or a fully developed woman, and they said, I really want to be the other gender. Well, they're already a man, they're already a woman. So it's kind of like a fantasy. So if they want to live out their fantasy, they can. Yeah. So let's say there's a guy and says, I really want to be a woman. I can actually be a pretty attractive woman. And there are some guys that do this. They actually dress up like girls. They have feminine features. They get breast implants, and they kind of really go for it. And they can fool you. They can fool you. So be careful.
I had Elaine Lancaster in, who was on a bunch of magazines. She was a Trump supporter. And because she was a Trump supporter, the trans community, shunned her. So I just had her in to talk to her or him. Well, 6'8", fucking walks in, the whole blonde, everything. Mm. Nicest person in the world.
Yeah, but some of these are attractive. So my point is, you have to be.
You got
to
be careful.
You got to be careful. So
when the lights go off.
Have you ever seen this? The Navy, their social media influencer, super influencer, is a guy who really dresses up as a cute girl. Oh yeah. Oh yeah, this is on my Instagram, and so it can be done, and I think it's a fantasy. I think for some gay guys, it's fun. They like to do it. They actually like to become girls. Most of the gay guys who do it have fully functioning penises and testicles, fully functioning, and they largely have anal sex with other guys.
Yeah,
and so if you ever go on Twitter and type in the and don't do it.
Type
in the hashtag shemale or femboy. It's basically porn. Twitter is a huge porn site, and it's basically guys with breast implants that look like girls, and when they take all their clothes off, they just get after, just having rectal sex with them, each other. That's what it is.
Yeah.
So that's largely what this transgender thing is in adults. Now, there are a few women who try to become men later on as adults. You probably saw Bruce Jenner. Remember, he tried?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And how about Richard Levine, who is now the Undersecretary for Health and Human Services? That is pretty rare, and it doesn't come out too good. So there's very few situations
successful.
Where, yeah, And then the girls, I should pick the example of the girls becoming guys. I'm trying to think, what are some famous ones where there's a girl became a man, public figure?
I don't know. The only one I really know is Jenner, because I just thought it was impressive
Jenner,
that Jenner came
and
on.
Richard Levine. But it didn't come out so well. There are some. Now, did you see... did you see that big pride picnic at the White House?
Yeah.
You see that? Yeah. So there's a guy.
With the lift of the shirt.
Yeah,
up.
Yeah. See the guy. So there's a guy. Now, he actually looks like a girl. I mean, he looks like
a girl. Yeah, I
thought
it was.
Yeah, I thought it was a girl, right? And he's got the curvy. He's got that pelvic. He had the curves, and he had this kind of Band-Aid dress on and stuff. And he's dancing around he with Biden. And then he just kind of gets a little too excited. Maybe he had too much alcohol. And so he's got the dress on. And he does something that's very uncharacteristic. A woman would never do this. He actually just pulls down the dress and he shows his breast implants. So, you know, the guys have the silicone breast implants.
Right.
And so they don't do a subpectoral implantation. It's actually just a subcutaneous. So they're just sitting there. And so you can just see that when he did that, the first thing that came out in my mind is he's a guy. It's a hot. And he's excited. It's like a guy pulling off his shirt at a football game, whatever. So that's the behavior of a guy. You would never see a girl do that.
Never.
Never.
Right.
So that's an example of they're still guys and they're still girls, right? But the point is, as an adult, it happens. It's largely a big gay kink. Since 2016, the Obama administration put into Obamacare that Medicare and Medicaid and commercial insurances must pay for gender change surgery so that the guys are getting free breast implants. Mm. Now, if a woman wants breast implants, she's got to pay for it herself, but men get it for free. That's what's going on. That guy got free breast implants.
Wow.
Yeah. Now let's take kids. Different story. Kids. Different story.
Yeah.
Kids are just normal kids. Kids all have some ambiguity and some gender dysphoria as they approach puberty. All the kids feel a bit awkward. You remember this. Then you go through puberty and you blossom into a man, blossom into a woman. This gender dysphoria now has become this clinical linchpin for triggering this idea that, well, you can change your gender or you should change your gender. And kids would never do that in the past. What's changed? Autism.
Autism. And aren't they going after kids with autism?
Yes. So kids.
That's what made me
kids
sick.
Kids with autism have poor peer relations. They feel ostracized.
That is sick to a
taste. This Dutch clinic described kids coming in for gender change surgeries who basically were autistic. And so the autistic kids don't fit in. They don't get boyfriends, girlfriends that easy. They're suggestible. They see the counselor, Tommy, and then they say, well, maybe you should change your gender.
Yep.
So it turns out that autism is a huge factor. There's a paper.
That is sick.
There's a paper that was done in LGBT people assessing for autism after the fact. They found it was off the Richter scale. These people are autistic. Yeah. They're largely autistic. And so that's what's driving kids changing their gender. So now what's happened is this has gone so out of control that all the medical societies are behind it. The Endocrine Society, the American College of Pediatrics, American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, they all say if a kid wants to change their gender, do it. And the surgeries are horrific. The mastectomies they're doing in the young girls leak. They try to strip all the breast tissue down to the pectoralis muscle. It looks awful. They get hunched over because it contracts. The surgery for the lower surgeries are absolutely terrible. So the girls are getting mastectomies. Down below, the girls are getting phalloplasties, where they take out a big hunk of the arm or the thigh, and they try to make a sausage penis. It's like a dead penis, basically. It doesn't work. It doesn't carry urine that well. It gets infected. Or they're trying to expand the clitoris, called a metidioplasty. Mm-hmm. That doesn't work very well at all. They get sterilized. They're disfigured. You can't go back. You can't go back in and do breast implants very well. They're trying to reposition the nipples. It gets infected. It's just, it's really.
It's called torture, basically.
It's awful, torture. Rob. The hormones they go on. Paper by Santos and colleagues, 59% of the kids who go on the hormones, because it's very unnatural for kids to take hormones, they get sick. They get headaches, nausea, vomiting, sleep disturbances, acne. You're not supposed to be taking hormones when you're a kid. So the hormones in the surgery on the girl's side is a disaster. It's going to sterilize them. After about a month, they never come back. After a month, they never come back. The voices changed. They regret it. On the boy's side, it's worse. The boys who try to become girls, the least worry is breast implants. Those are easy. They just pop in silicone breast implants. That's the least of the worry. The real problem is down below. So about 5% of the boys are getting castrated.
Wow, completely castrated.
Just take the testicles out. Some of them are getting a penectomy, getting the penis sliced off. The worst, though, is the penile inversion vaginoplasty.
When they try to make it like a clitoris.
Yeah, that's where they take the penis, and then they slice it open long ways like this. They slice it open, core it out, then invert it and stuff it back in and try to make it like a vagina. It stinks. It doesn't handle the secretions normally. It doesn't drain urine normally. It's a disaster. So the boys getting this penis surgery is horrendous. And once they get the lower stuff done, they're cooked. They're sterilized. So what we know now is the published studies show that doing this causes psychiatric problems, increases the burden of psychiatric disease, doesn't make it better. They're more likely to have suicide afterwards, homicide, death from other causes, mortality skyrockets. The states all over the country are saying, wait a minute, these transgender kids are dying. This is awful. They're trying to shut it down. So they try to shut it down in Georgia, Arkansas, Texas, and then right behind it, the American Civil Liberties Union is ACLU, is overturning these and say, no, we're putting stays on the bans. All the big medical centers are doing it because Medicare and commercial insurances have to pay for it, so it's a cash cow. Like, what ethical doctor would remove normal breasts and surgically damage normal genitalia? So I've stated publicly, listen, we shouldn't have transgender medicine because no ethical doctor would do this. We shouldn't have to have laws to ban it.
But how much do they make a month on that?
Well, we're down to the same thing. The same doctors doing transgender medicine are the same doctors who denied treating COVID and supported the vaccines. They're one and the same.
Okay. So isn't that a shock?
You know something is really bad. Where during COVID, you could say, listen, it was a medical emergency. Nobody knew what to do. This was thrust upon us. But there's no transgender emergency. We can slow down. We can analyze this. We can... So
take it a step further where if you're a kid in school, they can... What were you saying? They can arrest you or fine you if... You could go to your teacher in school at 8 years old and say, hey, I want to be a girl. And they don't tell the parents.
Right. So some schools, California, Washington, I think they're working towards criminalizing parents.
Criminalizing parents.
In Canada, Australia, New Zealand, it's interesting how the same countries that had terrible lockdowns and stuff are doing the same thing.
But I always wonder, like, if we put 5,000 people in this room right now, like, just pick random, just walk out there and pick 5,000 people. How many people, if we put them in this room and we said, you know, nothing to do with gay, nothing to do with any of that, but if we said we want to cut that 5-year-old's penis off and make him be a girl, how many would say, that's a great idea. I think we should do that. I have to think there'd be zero people that would say that. The vast, like, minority that is saying that this is normal and okay, I just can't see it.
Rob, I don't know. How much is a minority? Listen, I was just up in New Hampshire. I had a chance to meet some great people up there. One of them is Joe Matarisi, very successful guy, runs one of the largest physician staffing organizations in the United States. I met his son, high school student, goes to a very high-end private high school. He says it's running 20% in his class. He said in the fall, people go to school and he'll have friends. And then the boys in the spring are girls. Yeah, they are transitioning. No, it is a mental contagion. There's a contagiousness to it. It's going nuts. Do you know all the doctors were having to go through training to keep our licenses of transgender medicine to support it?
Gosh.
The correct answer on a medical test is start puberty blockers. That's the correct answer on like a board certification test now.
On a board certification test?
Yes.
Wow.
You know, when kids are like teenagers, I always think about this, right? You used to call them like the ugly duckling, right? The ugly duckling, right? You had a girl you went to high school with, or a boy. It could be vice versa. And they were just not that good looking during their teenage years, right? They're just, whatever. They had acne. They had all that different type of stuff. And then 15 years go by and you see that same girl that you used to make fun of, and oh man, she's got acne on her face and she's a little bigger, and you're like, damn, she's hot. Or damn, he's hot.
People blossom. You ever go back to high school?
Yeah. And we're not letting that happen. These kids are being told.
Oh, good point.
They're going through that point where you're ugly, you're this. So they're like, oh, I don't, no girls like me. No girls like me, or no guys like me. Well, let me just switch my sex and now I'll be attractive to another.
And now I have a new group.
Yeah. It's fucked up.
Yeah. Like say I'm like I was an asshole in high school and I would throw a cupcake at the dork at lunch.
Ah, I knew it.
I did like a jerk because I play sports and everything. But now that kid that everybody's throwing cupcakes at, he can go to his counselor and say, hey, I want to be a girl, right? So now he does this. Now he has his own group where he's accepted mm-hmm. that nobody throws yeah. cupcakes at. You know, it's just like a comfort thing.
Yeah, I think that's part cult of it. Almost. It's an infectious like contagion. It's very costly. It's very damaging. The kids can find other ways of co-aggregating with one another. Countries are banning it. In the UK, they just banned the puberty blockers. We can't move quick enough to ban this stuff. I was shocked because the Texas Attorney General's office contacted me. And they said, Dr. McCullough, we just banned transgender medicine here, and the ACLU or some group has just overturned the ban. They got to stay on the ban. Mm. They said, can you put in a statement just telling the state what are the risks of transgender medicine? We can't find a prominent doctor to speak against transgender medicine.
Too much money.
It's just like we can't find a qualified doctor to speak against the vaccines. It's the same thing.
Same thing. They're all connected together.
They're connected.
It's crazy because you have to be what?
Wow.
Again, I say legally all the time. I say legally. You have to be legally 18 to buy cigarettes. You have to legally be 21 to consume alcohol and buy alcohol. You have to legally be, I think, 18 without your parents' consent to get a tattoo. But if you're 5, you can say, eh, you know what? I'm just going to get my penis cut off and it's okay. It makes no sense,
Things that make no sense, one should really carefully look at them and think, are we in some crazy time where the human mind isn't thinking correctly? One of the people I've brought on my show is Miriam Grossman. You ought to look her up. New York City. She's the lead child psychiatrist out there. Wonderful woman. She's already testified in Congress. And she has a new book out called Lost in Transnation. Two words, transnation.
Lost in Transnation.
It's got, you might look it up on Amazon. It's got a aqua green cover. It's a how-to guide for parents. Parents are terrified what's going to happen. And what she says is gender affirmation is actually a good term. When the little kids are growing up, you should affirm their gender. When they're small,
right.
Like when the little baby boy say, listen, you're a baby boy. You're going to grow up to be a big man like your dad. You're a baby boy. Let's do this. So a boys ought to be affirming affirmed by their parents or boys. Girls ought to be affirmed that they're girls. They should not be exposed to pornography. Taking these kids out to drag queen festivals and stuff, that's a mess. Don't do that.
No,
that's a mess. Keep it clean. Affirm their genders, because once they leave your hands and they go to school, they're going to have to navigate themselves and say, no, that doesn't look right to me. What she says is you should ask your kids questions like, are other kids changing clothes at school?
Hmm.
Are boys showing up in boys' clothes and changing girls? Did you find it? Lost in Transnation. That's it.
That's it right there.
That's the how-to guide. Any parent right now, kids K through 12, Jordan Peterson wrote the cover. He's the famous psychologist from Canada.
Yeah.
I've interviewed Grossman on my show a couple times now. She's absolutely wonderful. You should try to have her on. And she's the one who's basically said, listen, if the kids are, you know, depressed and anxious and, you know, semi-suicidal and what have you, approaching puberty, the best cure for that is to go through normal puberty. It will solve the problem. It's very important.
All right, let it fix itself.
Let it fix itself. If they need some psychological counseling, fine. But the answer is don't start puberty blockers and hormones, which cannot be reversed in a month. They cause permanent changes, and don't start doing surgery. That's not the answer for this is a problem that's been going on since the beginning of mankind.
Yeah.
And we can't suddenly, what we've been talking about today are concrete examples where something has gone very wrong worldwide in human thinking. Worldwide, it's settled down on the world where collectively all over the world, people aren't thinking straight. Some people are, we're looking at this in horror, like, oh my gosh, this is a horror that a man would chop off his penis and a woman would chop. But other people are
just going about their day.
Other people are just blind, like, oh, it's okay.
It's okay. Let me go back on TikTok or Instagram or whatever it may be.
We are in very, very unique times, no doubt about it.
Is it true that the CDC put out a set of guidelines for males to breastfeed? Or is that not true?
It's
true.
It's true, and it's obscene.
Are you serious? That's true?
Yeah, they have guidance on the CDC.
Sorry.
To try to manipulate a male breast tissue. To try to get it to produce some milk. Because probably some...
As a doctor, you want to explain that one?
if a man ever did this, which is... well, first off, the baby is born to a normal mother.
Now that you said that is true. Okay. Anyone watching or listening that doesn't think that there's a little something wrong
right
now.
So
there's a loony bin in Pennsylvania. I can tell you where to go.
Yes, loony bin time.
They take your shoelaces.
The baby is born to a normal mother. The normal mother's breasts... have been prepared. They're engorged. They're ready to feed the baby. The baby should get breastfed from the normal mother. That's first off. Now, some guy over here who wants to breastfeed, that's a separate issue. A, he should kind of not want to breastfeed. That's bizarre. And even if he tried to breastfeed, he would have to pump himself up with hormones, try to get the male breast to try to secrete something. And then even if it's secreted, it would be kind of watery, loaded with foreign hormones in it. You wouldn't want a baby to even get near that.
But the CDC has nothing better to do than come out with the guidelines on how for a man.
Well, that's the point. This is a mental contagion. It's infecting normal medical systems, normal academic medical centers, the CDC, the Endocrine Society, Pediatric Society, the OB-GYN Society. One of my friends from Penn, University of Pennsylvania, Stanley Goldfarb, published with him in the past. Stan saw this happen, and he goes, I can't sit back and watch this happen. This is a catastrophe. So he formed an organization called Do No Harm. Do No Harm. And he's speaking out against this. And what he's doing, the right thing, he's showing up at the Endocrine Society and these other transgender medicine meetings. And he's given the opposing viewpoint, saying, listen, this isn't right. Here's the reason why. He's tried to engage in dialogue. He's had to file some lawsuits. He did get the American Association of Pediatrics to finally agree to do an evidence review on this. They haven't agreed to stop supporting it, but at least they're going to review the evidence on this. And he's trying to present a rational side for not going down this pathway. It's not going to end good. Jordan Peterson is out there big time saying, listen, Europe has already done this for 10 or 15 years, and they're pulling out now. It's a bad thing to do. They're realizing they've caused great harm. We have a chance now to stop this snowball. From 2016 to 2020, the number of male breast implants and then the lower surgeries of boys and girls has basically doubled in 4 years. And it's going to continue to go in a large scale unless we shut it off now.
Jordan Peterson's kind of like his writer. You know, Gadsad? Exactly like Peterson. Gadsad. Mm. We had him on. Mm-hmm. You should look into him. Because I was like,
how you spell it?
It's actually Gadsad.
G-A-D-S-A-A-D. Two ways.
Yeah, he's with Peterson all the time. He'll come out first, and then Peterson will go.
Oh, I have something interesting for you. Guess what the school district is in the United States that shut down pornography coming in the schools? Remember, how you get the kids to change gender is you hypersexualize them. So the pornography is pouring into the schools. People don't even know where it's coming from. But if you heard about this gay queer and all these books, there are standard pediatric children's textbooks that are teaching the kids how to do oral sex and everything else. You heard about it, right, Rob? So they're hypersexualizing the kids, the drag queens. These guys are coming in, dancing all over. It's nuts. Anyhow, there was, and parents are saying, listen, they, this is flowing in. The parents don't know what to do. Nobody knows where the pornography is coming from. Honestly, they don't know. The counselors are going off to training on how to teach the kids how to do oral sex. There's sex clubs, all this other stuff going on.
What the hell?
Yeah, and little bitty kids. People have lost their minds. Anyhow, this is happening in schools all over. You look at your local school right now, and you go look at any materials they're teaching pornography.
Well, I already know my daughter's. Yeah. Unless things drastically change, homeschool.
Well, there you
I
go.
I was going to do private, but I too much bullshit in private.
Well, anyhow, this rose to a level, and then one school system completely shut down. The parents that were pulling all of our kids out, not a single kid to go to school until this crap gets out of the school. And they held meetings, and they held strong. And do you know where it was?
Where?
Dearborn, Michigan.
Oh, wow.
And who's in Dearborn, Michigan? The Arabs. And they're largely Muslims. Wow. There's a lot of Muslims there.
Right.
And they said, get this crap out of the schools. The Muslim religion does not allow pornography at any level. It's unacceptable to us. Isn't America a great country where the Muslims step up and shut down this crap?
And doesn't that relate to what Chris, the IQ guy, kind of said in a way? Muslims came out and said, look, we're not doing it. That's the end of it.
Yeah.
And they're not doing it.
It's amazing.
It's amazing. I saw you had written, it's true, but I know a lot of people with diabetes. Vitamin D really helps with diabetes?
It can. You know, the main thing on diabetes is just not to get fat. So stay thin, lean. If there's a family history of diabetes, lay off. There's three things that make us fat. It's pretty easy. You don't get fat from eating too many apples. I've never seen somebody come in, say, doc, I eat 10 Granny Smith apples a day. I'm fat. I've never seen it. Never seen somebody come in and say, doc, I eat too many blueberries. I got fat as a cow. Never. People get fat from three things. There's the three S's. Sugars, sweets and treats, starches, things made out of flour, and that's any baked good at all, potatoes and rice, and then saturated fats. Pizza, burgers and fries, gooey cheeses, greases, red meats, chicken. You get fat from eating that stuff. So the three S's over and over and over again. Cut out the three S's. That means high quality sources of protein in this order: fish, beans, nuts, egg whites, non-fat dairy, occasional lean meats, and fresh fruits and vegetables. You keep pushing away those starches, the saturated fats and sugars. That's what you need to do. And that stay lean. That's your best chance of not getting diabetes. Looking at you, you're lean. Best chances. My dad had diabetes at the end of the senior home. I'm trying to run it lean.
I always get, fruit has sugar in it. Same sugar as soda.
Don't worry about it.
Even though it's the same type of sugar as soda, or it's different?
It's different. Don't worry about
it. It is different. Rob wanted to ask you about the wildfires.
Two quick things, actually. One, we had a guy in here 2 weeks ago or last week, and we talked about a gallon of water and putting 2 teaspoons of salt in your
Himalayan salt.
Himalayan salt. Benefits to that you know of? Anything that with like weight loss and with
he's an extreme pilot. He goes 9 Gs. He broke the record in like an F-16, whatever. And he works out heavy. Not heavy. He works out a lot where he sweats and stuff to condition. And he swears by, and so does Rogan, your buddy, Himalayan salt, pink Himalayan salt in with a gallon of water. Because if people go running the treadmill, then the sauna, and they quick drink that gallon of water, it just goes through the system. You pee it out. But if you put that pink Himalayan salt in, it retain, you know, sodium, water retention, then it hydrates you more because you don't just hammer a gallon of water, pee it out.
Right.
With the salt, it will hold it and slowly excrete it and rehydrate you better.
Well, you can. There's certainly been experiments with giving IVs. So if we give a liter of normal saline, which would be equivalent to this Himalayan salt idea, within 2 hours, only a quarter of that is left in the bloodstream. You pee it out or it goes into tissues. So even the salt water goes pretty quickly into tissues. But if people take a little salt in with whatever they drink, that's fine. I ran a ton of marathons in my lifetime, and I used to look in the mirror afterwards in the shower, and I'd have white frost all over my face. Tons of salt. So you lose a ton. So, you know, I learned to take little salt packets. You know, one time I got a little bit low. I ran Miami, and I think I got hyponatremic, and I learned to kind of manage the salt. But most of us are so loaded with salt, don't worry about it. No one's unless you're running a marathon or something like this. If you go to Lifetime Fitness, you can run on a treadmill for 20 minutes. You don't need to be drinking gallons of Himalayan salt. You can just...
When you're doing your marathons, do you drink just water primarily?
No, I try to drink electrolyte mix. And
you do?
Yeah, I haven't raced in a long time.
Your own kind? Like your own cocktail?
No, just whatever they have. You know, I ran a couple marathons where they only offered water all the way. It was one of the Canadian ones that was tough. But no, I always try to mix it up. I ran a marathon in every state in the United States.
You did?
No, have you ever met anybody who's done that?
No.
Never had anybody on the show who's done that?
No.
The first.
No. Yeah, there he is, the king.
God
the king.
Dang.
There you go, guys. There you go. Let's wrap it up.
Okay. Let's wrap it up. What was with the wildfire thing?
Just the last thing, and then we can cut it here. Wildfires. You've heard about what happened over in Hawaii, and we'll go with the rational theorist versus conspiracy theorist, good. Okay? You've seen these videos of this ravaging fire. To me, the stories that I'm hearing is basically this was done purposely, and they ravaged this land, and now they're just going to overtake it because some native lands, there are some native things, and they're going to be like, you know what? This is prime real estate, and we're taking it over. Have you looked any much into that? Any ideas?
Well, we're going to get reports from investigative journalist John Leake, so we'll find out. Yeah. You know, John's brother lives on Maui, so he's got scoop.
I'd like to know about that.
But it's clearly a catastrophe.
Yeah.
Apparently, Lahaina, the wood's really dry. It's been dry. The heat blows down from the mountains. You know, it's like a tinderbox. What's being portrayed to us is very similar. You know that story out off New England where the boat gets caught in the water? It's the perfect storm.
Yeah.
Remember the movie?
The perfect storm? Yeah, yeah.
It's the same thing. This was the perfect storm for the fire.
Just perfect.
And people got scorched. The other thing that's really, I think, a tragedy that will come out in some of the stories is this occurred at a time where the kids were not back to school. So a lot of parents were at work.
Mm.
This thing swept through so quickly. The kids were at home, and the fire is on the house, and what do the kids do?
Yeah.
What are they supposed to do? And, you know, I think there are around 100 reported dead, 1,000 missing, a lot of kids.
Sure.
And the kids may have just been incinerated. And what's been reported to John is that it's almost like Pompeii. People were just fried right there.
Yeah.
It sounds horrific.
I'd like to know when he gets back.
Yeah, you should have him. You should have him on. John is going to do a lot. He's going to actually try to write a book on it.
He said he was in the middle of a book or something. Then he was going to head down.
Yeah, he's working on his finale. He's been working on for a long time. It's called Black Widow. It's a serial murder case.
That's what he said. Yeah,
a real case in Dallas, and it's gonna
Black Widow. Yeah.
It's gonna come forward. You know, he wrote. Too Cold for Too Long, which is about it's a murder that occurred in Austria, I think Austria, or one of the European countries. And, you know, that really was a gripping novel. And it's hard to write a gripping novel. And ours, as you know, is gripping. It kind of gets
easy
you.
Easy read. It's an easy read.
Yeah, it keeps you going. Yeah. And it is kind of fun. Chapter 11 in our book right there. Cuomosexuals.
Yeah.
Wasn't that a good one? Like, yeah,
it doesn't matter. You finish it. You finish that chapter.
Like, wait,
I'm not bullshitting either.
But I want to read it. Wait a minute. Cuomo. That's Andrew Cuomo and Chris Cuomo. Yeah, we want to learn about that. Another fun part of the book is when I'm in the U.S. Senate testifying for the first time.
Oh.
And by the audiobook, by the way, John reads it, but the parts where my Lincoln Memorial address and my Senate testimony, whatever, it's really my voice. They actually get the real audio from the voice.
When he was in, I had to go. When I got home, I played the audio again to see if it was him.
Yeah.
I wasn't 100. I thought it was, but I wasn't 100% sure.
John,
that's always cool.
John's real particular because we interviewed some voices. We tested out some, and he wanted to do it himself. Anyhow, so one funny part of the book was you know, I'm going up against Ashish Jha.
Mm-hmm.
And Ashish Jha was one of the guys. He was in on this whole thing. He's part of the pandemic planning processes and all this. And he's this really smug guy who was at Harvard. Now he's like a young dean at Brown. And he's on CNN all the time. And, you know, he's scared to go to Washington. So he comes by Zoom. You know, all the heroes, we've been treating patients. We go to Washington. You know, we're not afraid. So anyhow, you know, after I'm, you know, telling America I can treat COVID, I got McCullough Protocol, this is working. And, you know, it's one classic thing where I hold up my protocol and I said, listen, I'm not asking for permission to do this. I'm doing it. You know, I just, everyone was like, yeah. And so Johnson knows that this guy, Zha, is essentially a fraud. And we had already planned this out in the session. Johnson said, I'm going to let this go pretty far. Then I'm going to ask Zha. He goes, Dr. Zha, have you ever treated a COVID patient? Have you ever seen a COVID patient? You know, for 2 hours, he was advising America on what to do in COVID. He, as a doctor, he had never even seen a case. And he goes,
buried.
He goes, no, Dr. Johnson, or Mr. or Senator Johnson, I have not seen COVID. And everyone's like, this guy's a fraud. You got McCullough and all these guys. McCullough's actually treating patients. This guy's a fraud. So John writes this in the book. It's really funny.
Perfectly, too.
He writes it in the book, and he goes, about that time, he said, Dr. Zha must have felt like an aerospace engineer who never flew on a plane, or a marriage counselor who was never married. You know? That was great. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know these guys who claim to be experts and stuff, but they've never really life done it themselves?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Life coaches.
The life coaches are the best.
Yeah.
That's the best. Well, pull up tab two and the foundation.
Yeah, so yeah, there. We're going to...
And then we'll wrap it up. Yeah, get that spike support.
Get some spike support. Get that crud out of your body.
Fly off
the shelves. Two capsules twice a day. Wellness company. Got to get it. Everyone.
We'll have that at the top of the description, and then the foundation.
There's foundation. Please visit McCullough Foundation. Need your support. I'm all over the country. Out here today. Tomorrow we'll be in Vegas. We're going on Clay Clark. Going to give a stage presentation on Clay Clark. Boy, those are a lot of fun. It's a big adult party. Clark, a lot of energy. Clay Clark, General Flynn, Mike Lindell. And it's kind of a hardcore Brandon House, awesome. Kind of hardcore right wing. But, you know, I love those guys. I love the energy, you know, the freedom people they want. Freedom.
Yeah.
And, you know, and right now, if there's anything that America can galvanize around, it's freedom. Most of us just want to be left alone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? We just want to live our lives. We don't want to
go
back to normal. We don't want anybody to tell us to wear a mask. We don't want anybody to screw us up on our travel. We don't want anybody to tell us to take any more shots.
Stop messing with the economy and making things.
Right. Yeah. Just like crazy. We just want to be left alone. I think that's it. And so, Clay Clark, Reawaken America, great program. I'm going to be speaking at the Facts Matter conference in Copenhagen. Really great lineup. I'm going to meet some people I haven't met. I haven't been over to Europe now. I used to go to Europe in academic medicine half a dozen times a year. I haven't been there in several years through the pandemic. So going to Copenhagen. I'll be back. I've got clinic in Dallas, and I'll be back in Europe in Strasbourg in mid-September testifying at the European Parliament. And Christine Anderson over there has been a real fireball. She's been like Senator Johnson, but like Rand Paul. Rob Roos from the Netherlands. I've had a chance to meet both of them. They've came over to the United States. Great folks. And then I'll be back. I'll be working it through the fall. A lot of activity in the court. McCullough Foundation is supporting all this. I'm helping people, Canadian courts, U.S. courts. There's some of these cases now that I've gotten to the point of a jury trial. People being screwed over in the hospital and dying. These shots causing horrific problems. People don't want to take any more shots. The military, they don't want to take any shots. You hear about the military helicopter, I think just Black Hawk. A guy basically had a cardiac arrest, a young guy. They forced it on and he survived. And it's out in the media now. They called me. I told them, listen, he survived. But now you got to investigate the vaccine. The vaccine is, well, we know now in a paper by Holscher and colleagues in preprint, I'm the senior author. It is the vaccines.
Congratulations.
Yeah. We're, the vaccines are causing the cardiac arrest. Unless 100%. They come out and say, we didn't take a vaccine, it is the vaccine until proven otherwise. I'm going to have to let that be the last word. Thank you so much.
That's it. Well, next time you fly back in, you might be in a mask, and then you can tell me about sleep.
Oh, no.
You can tell me about sleep.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
guys are great.
Thank you. This episode is sponsored by Aurora. Do you know what the fastest growing crime in America is? For years, this crime rate has been surging and affecting millions of Americans. I'm talking about identity theft, and there's a new victim every 14 seconds.
Yet despite this, those who have had their identity stolen are often shocked when it happens. That's why I'm excited to partner with Aurora, who is sponsoring this video. Aurora is identity theft protection, fraud monitoring, a VPN, password management, and antivirus software all into one easy-to-use app. Their VPN allows you to stay anonymous online by keeping your browsing history and personal information safe and encrypted. Protect you and your family from America's fastest-growing crime. Try Aurora for free for 2 weeks and see if you or anyone in your family's personal information has been compromised. Start your free trial today. Go to aurora.com/mscs. The link is in the description below.